Today is April 11th, 2016. This is Aaron Wulf here. It's about 3:15 p.m. If you're listening to this now, it means that I'm dead. I'm obviously recording this before I died. There's a lot I want to say. There's a lot that needs to be said. I'm not sure how long this is going to be. I'm not sure what I'm even going to say, but I just want to record some thoughts, some feelings, some things that I have deep inside that I've been trying for 35 years to have someone take seriously. And with my luck, now that I am dead, this will all be taken seriously, and there will finally be justice for Aaron. But again, only when I'm dead. I don't know what society could have expected from a man like me, who came through what I did and survived probably more trauma and violence and torture by the age of 5 than I can guarantee you any man who was 80 years old would have seen in his lifetime. And then by the age of 10, I saw more violence probably than anyone who lived 200 years. By the age of 20, I probably saw more violence than men who lived 1,000 years combined. And throughout it all, I never lost the love in my heart. I never lost the compassion in my soul. I never lost my desire to make this world a better place, to see society as good despite the evil that was done to me by everyone around me. And as I go through this last part of my life, knowing I'm going to be dead soon, as soon as I finish this letter and the legal cases that have been taking me forever, while I've been physically dying, while I've been grieving the worst pain you can imagine after losing your soulmate and fiance, while in terrible physical health, frail health, and being in the home of the worst predators and violent psychopaths you've ever met, while Jan and Art literally threatened my life, have been violent towards me, been encouraging me to commit suicide repeatedly over and over, as I've been barricaded in the bedroom literally for 23 and a half hours a day plus for the last 3 months, with boxes against the door, unable to leave for fear that they will try to physically kill me, as Art has tried repeatedly, just since I've been back. So I sit here recording this, thinking to myself, what was the point of my life? What was the point of always trying to do right? Of overcoming impossible odds and a past of such hell and trauma and despair that never ceased. It never ceased. For my entire life, for 35 full years, because I turn 36 in 9 days from now, and I'll be dead shortly after that, I was never able to have a day off, even since I was a little kid. And I know the violence started before 1985, when I was 5, but that's all I remember. I remember going to kindergarten with bruises so bad I couldn't sit down. And they say it's not uncommon for children to not remember things that came before that. But to know my whole life I have had to battle this every single day, and the threats to my life and the violence and the trauma has never gone away. It has never stopped. Again, as I said, Jan and I are still trying to kill me to this day. They're still committing crimes against me to this day. They still have the money that I earned in the 1980s as a child actor in their accounts to this day. I will die in complete poverty. I will die with the worst heartbreak known to man. I will die in the worst physical pain, and I can guarantee you serial killers died better than I did. I reached out to 4 family members, direct family members, and they all wished me death. I reached out to 4 other family members, extended family members, they refused to help me. Reached out to a trauma psychologist who refused to call me back when I said my parents are trying to kill me, which she knew because she flat out said they were one of the worst sets of parents she'd ever heard in over 20 years. And I said I was going to kill myself, and she didn't care. I don't understand how one man can have faced so much evil in his lifetime and to have survived it, to have created beautiful work in it, to have strived his whole life to be able to contribute positively to society and to make the world better for everyone, safer, healthier, and better. For what? For me to end up dying in the end completely alone with no help and no one who would listen to me. And I know with my death, I'm confident with how my life went as worst case scenario. I am confident that my letter will be taken seriously. People will be put in prison. There will be justice for Aaron. Fine. I wanted justice when I was alive. I deserve justice when I was alive. Any one of those events of trauma in my letter destroys someone's life. I had well over 1,000 alone just in the house with Jan and Art Wolf and their kids and the psychopaths that they are and what they did to me. I survived that. You can look at any photo of me. You can look in my eyes. Photos of me as a kid. Photos of me in my 30s. No one keeps that smile, that loving smile on his face through that. You can't fake a loving smile. You can't fake the compassion in my eyes. You can't. And I didn't, because it was genuine and it was true. I wanted more for my life. I wanted more for this world. I not only wanted to make the world better and had the plans to make it better, but I was going to make it better. And society treated me for all of the evil people in my letter, including every member of the Wolf family that are complete mentally ill psychopaths, Jan, Art, Stacy, Seth, and Zachary, and their adopted felon and con artist, David. And why no one will listen to me, I don't know. Why the Northbrook police could come to the house so many times as a kid when I'm covered in welts and bruises and choke marks and blood, and I'm begging them for help and they ignore me when they'd already investigated Art for child abuse earlier. And why they would ignore a 14-year-old boy or a 15-year-old boy or a 6-year-old boy and take the side of a parent, I don't know. I was a strong kid, but I can assure you at the age of 14, when I'm 4'11" and 95 pounds, it's probably hard to take out a man who's 5'9", 180 pounds plus. But every time the police were like, yep, you are the troublemaker, Aaron. Yeah, clearly. Clearly. Art Wolf never hid his violence. He will go to his grave, whether it's at the age of 75 or 150. However long this man will live, because he has never died, even after having 8 heart attacks and angioplasties, he threatened the lives of thousands of people with violence, because I personally witnessed hundreds of it. And this man has not stopped doing this for the last 50 years of his life. He has been evil to his core since he was a child. That's what his sister said. His violence. Same thing with Jan. Yet these people were never stopped. Even when they beat me in public, at the pool, at the sports fields, at the mall, in front of the house, the number of people who witnessed me being violently beaten by this savage, by this mentally ill psychopath, the most violent sadistic man I've ever met, the number of people who witnessed this violence is in the hundreds and hundreds and hundreds. And I kid you not, because the proof is undeniable, not a single person ever reported it. Because if they had, he would have been arrested. This would have stopped at the age of 5 or 8 or 12 or even 18, and I could have had the last 18 years of my life to get away. Instead, I spent the last 18 years of my life trying to get away from these psychopaths, because they are the absolute textbook definition of what mentally ill, deranged psychopaths are, every single member of their family and their kids. I was the only sane one in this family. I was the only one who had love in my heart. I was the only one that cared. I was the only one that wanted to do more for this world, whereas every single one of them take and destroy instead. They are all destroyers. I was the one that had love in my heart. You can hear it in my voice. You cannot fake this. And now I'm dead because no one will listen to me. The police wouldn't listen to me. The teachers who knew about the violence didn't report it. The coaches who knew about the violence didn't report it. The neighbors who knew about the violence didn't report it. Extended family, friends, my friends' parents, everyone, medical doctors. You know how many therapists I told? As a kid, I was being violently beaten at home, and there was photographic evidence. They didn't care. Jeffrey Spector was one of them. He didn't care. He didn't report it. Why do you pay a psychologist or a psychiatrist for help? First off, I didn't choose to go to them. The problems I had as a kid, I can assure you they were not my fault. They were the destruction and annihilation of my foundation by Jan and Art Wolf with their violence that never ceased. But I was the problem even as a 14-year-old boy, and I was sent to these doctors. And truthfully, it was probably a good thing in a general sense to expose me to being in touch with my emotions, understanding what happened, talking it out, because I could always talk it out with people. I always needed that. I needed someone to talk to make sense of why all this was happening. And when I didn't have that, when I didn't have people that would help me, I'd turn to my journal and I'd write. And I will have died, and I will have written, no joke, over 20,000 pages typed in my journal from the age of 15 through my death, trying to make sense of this violence, trying to make sense of how every single person in society, hundreds of people, could never have come to the aid of that adorable little boy. And I can't make sense of this. I don't understand this. I don't know how this could happen. Anyone who reads my letter will say, how could all of this happen to one boy, let alone someone who never once tried drugs in his entire life? I didn't even try marijuana. I never tried smoking. I tried alcohol 3 times in my entire life at the age of 18, and never before and never after. That is 1 in 10 billion with someone who went through 10 events of trauma, let alone well over 1,000. And I calculated that in my letter, well over 1,000. I was an anomaly. I was a miracle. This is what my fiance and soulmate said: you are a miracle. No one survived this, let alone with the love in his heart and the man you are, with your integrity and your morals. But what was the point? In the last 3 months of my life, as I've been tying up my affairs and writing these letters and doing this video and doing these legal cases, I can't tell you the inner torture I've felt, knowing that I was going to die despite having looked death in the eyes hundreds and hundreds of times. And no matter how many people tried to kill me, no matter how many people tried to poison me, no matter how many times I was violently beaten or tortured or had death or rape threats or could not sleep due to the violent nightmares or was in starvation because of the poverty, no matter what, nothing could kill me. No one could kill me. And in the end, the only way I died was at my own hands because of the pain of losing the only person that I ever loved, that ever loved me, and was my best friend and my only family. It was my fiance and soulmate. Why would I want to go on in this world when no one in this world did their part to stop this violence? How could an aunt and uncle in early 1991, when I was still 10 years old, know about the violence, insist I drop my drawers to take photos of the violence, documentation of the beatings, and then hide those photos for the next 25 years until I reached out to them for the first time in 23 years since talking to them, since Jan cut them out of the family and refused to let them talk to us. I contacted them in March 2016, asked for those photos. I had those photos in hand immediately after thinking about those photos hundreds and hundreds of times. Why would an aunt and uncle take those photos and make the effort to do 99% of the task and not do the 1% that was the most important part? I don't know. Because Jan and I could immediately have been arrested, put in prison for probably a decade. Their kids would have been pulled out of the house by DCFS immediately, and I could have started anew at the age of 10. Instead, the last 25 plus years of my life have been fucking hell. They have been hell. They've never ceased. But you know what? Until my soulmate died, I never gave up faith. I never gave up hope that my life would get better, and I didn't just sit there praying for rain. I was never naive. I learned new skills. I constantly had healthy habits. I constantly worked on my craft. I feel I did a pretty incredible job. If you see my photos and writing, I did a pretty incredible job of getting as close as you can to really excelling in that. I don't think you ever master photography or writing, but I think I did an incredible job despite the inner turmoil and hell and complex PTSD and trauma that I live with my entire life. And to have done that, to have created 25 years of work just in the last 10 years alone, and it was all destroyed before I died. 150,000 photographic images from around the world, and over 50,000 pages of typewriting, including 3 years of content that was ready to be launched from my site. I didn't want to leave it behind. I didn't want to leave it for this world. It wasn't worth it to me. I didn't get to make a living with that. I didn't get to succeed with my fiance, who helped me put all this together in an incredible publishing platform and empire that she helped me build. If I couldn't do it with her, I didn't want to do it with anyone. And so be it. My life went in the exact opposite way it should have, despite the things I did. Again, I stayed out of trouble. I wasn't perfect, no, but the only kid, the two boys in the family, Seth and Zachary, I can't tell you how many times they were arrested, how much trouble they got into, how many substances they put in their body or in their noses, everything that you could find on a table, they snort it or inhale it. They're toxic. They're psychopaths. They wished me death after knowing my soulmate died and I was dying. They didn't care. This is the mental illness that permeates the Wulf name. I was the only sane one, clearly. And I died before all of them. I worked out every day when I was around a gym or I wasn't traveling, the times I could travel. I started lifting weights at the age of 14 because if I did not, I was going to get killed in that house. Make no mistake about it. Cal Ripken Jr. was my hero and my childhood role model. I mean, he was an incredible man. He taught me my morals and my values and my integrity. He taught me to respect my body. He taught me my work ethic. And he was the reason I never drank into drugs. He was the single reason that I never wavered, even in the pain that I was in. And again, you ask any psychologist or psychiatrist or medical professional to read my letter, my final letter, and say, tell me, does this boy survive this? No. Does this boy survive without turning to drugs and alcohol and winding up in prison? No. It's statistically impossible, but I did. With still having that loving smile and compassion in my heart. But this is the influence Cal Ripken Jr. had on me. I waited my entire life to be able to get to this man and to give him a hug and say, thank you, Dad, for teaching me the right way to do this. And I died, and I never got that chance. I never got that chance to thank the man who helped save me as a kid. And in the end, I didn't get saved. In the end, all of the dreams I had for my life did not come true because I could not get away from Jan and Art Wulf. Even when I left, they took about $500,000 worth of tax deductions or my earnings, even through my 20s. They all went into Art's bank account, and he had the money disappear. He intercepted checks. He signed my name on checks. He cashed out stocks I didn't know about. My whole life, I was never told about these things. I was being bled out at $1,500 a month. You know what my medical bills were from therapy alone? I never got to have physical therapy from the hundreds of violent beatings where I could never touch my toes or squat down. I never got that opportunity. I was in pain every single day of my life. Through my death, from the age of 5 till my death, I had phantom pain, a tingling and numbing in my behind. It has never stopped through today. And when I found a doctor and I said to him, what is this? He said, it's phantom pain. It's the equivalent of you losing your arm but still being able to feel your arm there because your brain is so ingrained to feel that pain in your behind as a kid. This is what I live with. Severe pain, I never complained about the pain. I didn't know it wasn't normal until my fiance said, this is not normal. This is a result of this violence, of these mentally ill savages who were never stopped. And no matter what I tried to do to stop them, it never stopped. They never stopped. They committed, through 2012, foreclosure fraud against me, Jan and Art. They bought a condo in my name, sank it in my name, after forcing me into bankruptcy over $25,000 in negotiated debts. Even though there was money of mine in an account that could have paid for it that Art had hidden. He intentionally did this to me because he wanted to have a bankruptcy on my record so he could do a loan modification because they bought this property in Encino with my great credit. And all along, we don't have the money, Aaron. It was a $1,400 mortgage. Meanwhile, any flight records and travel itineraries can confirm 100% along with their emails in my letter. They were traveling around the globe at $50,000 a year. But for me, to commit crimes against me, that was part of their daily life, just like waking up and eating cereal. And it never stopped. They got to wish me death in the end, charge at me violently, keep me locked up in that room for fearing for my safety and my life. Through the end, this is what they did to me when I was a little boy. After violently beating me and keeping me locked in a room for 12, 18, 24 hours at a time without access to food, water, or bathroom. What 8-year-old boy, 10-year-old boy is supposed to endure that and not become crazy? Well, you can hear my voice. I did not. I'm pretty damn pragmatic. I had my problems. I had my issues. But you know what? I handled it better than anyone in history because no one would have survived that. And to die in the exact same way as I was as a kid with their torture, there is no justice. I can't possibly say there is a God. I started lifting weights at the age of 14. In order to protect myself. Once I stopped acting as a child actor at the age of 12, because I was no longer I was going through, you know, losing my teeth, and it was just an ugly period for kids, you know? You're just going through that awkward phase. It was no longer valuable to them. So instead of just beating me on behind or the legs, then they started choking me to death, trying to choke me to death. Art punched me in the face twice, broke my nose twice, shattered my nose. And years later, when I had to have it repaired because I couldn't breathe, I had to pay for it. And this is all documented. So I had to lift weights in order to save my life, and I did. And I got stronger than you can ever imagine for a kid, where by the age of 18, I could bench press more than twice my weight. While having these permanent injuries where I couldn't touch my toes or squat down. I tried to always avoid violence. I tried to always take the peaceful route. I was no pacifist, no. I don't believe in pacifism. If someone's trying to kill you, you defend yourself. And that was always my stance. I will never throw the first punch, because that was Art's rule. You always throw the last. And I always threw the last. The number of times someone came at me, that was the last punch that was thrown, the one that I threw, and they were on the ground. I didn't feel the need to hit someone 15 times. It was one time and be done, and then walk away or run away. Yet Art's rule was never throw the first punch, but always throw the last. But hundreds of times, he never once honored that rule. What kind of man tries to kill a 5-year-old boy, an 8-year-old boy, a 12-year-old boy? What kind of man tries to kill even a 30-year-old man or a 50-year-old man? This is the psychopathy that just permeates through every DNA cell of every member of the Wolf family but me. And when I am dead, I will be blamed for all of it. They blame me for everything. Seth, my brother, complete mentally ill psychopath, who loved getting me beaten as a child. He even took the belt from Jan and beat me. He'd get this sick look in his eyes when I was getting beaten. He said to me in 2007, it's in my letter, basically, well, all of us feel this way in this family, and it's your fault that this is going on. It's not our fault. We've loved you, and we've cared for you, and you never appreciate what we've done for you. But when you read that letter, you'll say, there's not a single member of the Wolf family that ever had my back, let alone not have my back but trying to kill me the whole time. They need to not just be locked up in prison for life. They need to be destroyed and never see daylight again. These are five of the greatest threats to society that have ever existed, and I am the most qualified person on the planet to say that with what I've been through. What was the point of my life? What was the point of telling them I was being sexually abused in high school and they do nothing? What was the point of telling them I'm having death and rape threats by Daniel Halpern in high school for over 2 years? They do nothing about it. What was the point when he's an attorney, Art, and does nothing to help me and only everything to hurt me and commit financial crimes against me through the end? He harmed me more, not just physically with his violence and his torture and his psychological abuse, but financially as well, and destroyed things legally when people did things to me that were not my fault. I did not deserve to be sexually abused by Stu Snow. I was. I told him. I told Jan. They did nothing about it. I told Jeffrey Spector. He did nothing about it. Spector protected his financial interests and contract with Glenbrook North. He did not want to be the one to tell his employer, by the way, I got a patient, Snow molested. Despite the fact I did a psychological evaluation on Snow and warned you he's bad news, I'm not going to tell you that, because you're going to get sued for $1 million by my patient, then I'll lose my contract. He committed a felony. Make no mistake about it. It's in my letter. It's a felony what he committed against me. This man who had millions in the bank did this to a boy who had not a dime in the bank, who he knew was coming from a violent home, who was being violently tortured and abused. And I told him over a dozen times. He never reported that either. This man is the most evil doctor you can ever imagine, and he's still practicing. Through the age of 71, even if they take his license away and put him in prison tomorrow, that man made $15 million in his lifetime, I'm sure. He did very well for himself. And I did not. I didn't have a day of my life to go forward, because no one would listen. No one would listen. No matter how many teachers I told that Daniel Halpern was threatening to rape and kill me, they did nothing. How many more coaches do I need to tell? I told Rupert, I told Pieper, I told Howie, I told Snow, I told Deans Leonard and Chichu. How many more people do I need to tell? This is a man who is one of the most mentally ill psychopaths, one of the worst children I've ever seen in my entire life, complete violent psychopath. He was never stopped. And then he attacks me at the very end of high school, which probably every class in my mind still remembers. In a gym with 400 people with the Northbrook police 30 feet away. Northbrook police didn't see it. the ironic thing, or truthfully, worst case scenario, what happens after the bully threatens to rape and kill you for 2+ years and finally does it? I'd beat the shit out of him so badly that the Northrop police would not press charges against him. Because his thugs said that I attacked him first, which is the most ironic thing. I went 2.5 years not attacking him, biting my tongue. Because that's what Art said to do, and that's what the coaches told me to ignore it, because it wasn't the consequences. The consequences weren't on them. Worst case scenario. Didn't matter, I already filed a police report with Northrop Police helping before. And they said, yeah, we're at the house on Sunset all the time. We know all about his father, Neil. We know they're bad news. We know it's a violent family. They knew that about them the same way they knew that about my family. And Jan and Art, they did nothing about it. The Northbrook police make no mistake about it. They're not just the most dangerous local police force in the country. It was a deliberate cover-up and corruption to choose not to take down Jan and Art Wulf when I begged for help. How many more people did I have to cry to? How many more tears did I have to shed? How many more people had to see the bruises or actually the beatings in public? And Nancy and Ron, my aunt and uncle in Skokie, who I told you, I said, I got these photos finally after 25 years. I asked them finally, why didn't you report this? Nancy said, well, we asked you what you know for what we should do, and you begged us not to do that. And as I say in my letter, you basically listen to a terrified 10-year-old boy, and you're blaming me for this, and I don't remember ever telling him not to do that, by the way. And she said, we just thought it basically resolved itself. And then they just disappeared from my life 2 years later and kept the photos and never did anything about them. To blame a child for their lack of action, to do 99% of right and the 1% wrong sunk the rest of the 99%, it is unfathomable to me. Unfathomable that anyone could be that evil and that cruel and that vicious. They harm me more themselves than I can ever quantify, because they could have stopped it then. Jan and Art could have been put in prison then. It would have been done then. And they didn't. And when I said to them, you ruined my life by not doing this. Do you know the violence and the number, the 1,000+ traumas I endured after this? Not just the physical acts of torture and the beatings, but the death threats, the rape threats, the sexual abuse, the financial crimes that destroyed the rest of the 25 years of my life before I die? Do you know what you did to me? And then Ron grabs the phone and the quotes in the letter as it is succinctly. And he basically said to me, you're lucky I don't get on a plane and come there and punch you in the face and break your nose. Don't ever call this number again. The uncle, Uncle Ron, such a great uncle who took the photos. Nancy didn't. He took the photos. He forced me to drop my drawers, not in an inappropriate way, but he knew they were beating me. He'd seen it. Takes the photos and then hides them in the basement for 25 years. And he said to me, we were hoping you'd call. Wow. The two deadliest aunt and uncles in history. And then he threatens me with violence for questioning them. I had the audacity to question them why they did not do what they were obligated to do after taking those photos. Anyone with a heart, anyone with a beating heart or a pulse would have done that, and they did not. And I'm to blame. This is exactly everyone that was around me. Complete psychopaths. Violence. Every single man around me was violent. Every father figure was either a pedophile, like Snow or Jeff Gulp, or violent and trying to torture me. How was I supposed to succeed? How was I supposed to stay calm and loving and compassionate? Somehow I did. I talked to a friend recently. And he said to me, I had no idea about any of this. I've known you for a decade. And I said, yeah. I said, I wasn't perfect. I had my issues. I handled this pretty damn well. And he says, yeah, you did. I would never have known. I would never have known even 1% of these things happened. I said, you don't even know 1/1000th of the story. I was the greatest survivor in history that no one ever got to meet. I was the strongest man in history to have survived what I did when no one could kill me, but also not turn out like a psychopath like my brother Zachary. Zachary is one of the most dangerous, destructive forces of nature. That's what happens when you get beaten as a kid. But he got 1% of the beatings. Make no mistake about it, I got 99%. And Stacy and Seth never got hit. So it's so easy for them to talk about what a piece of shit I am and how I was the problem. When I shielded all of them, make no mistake about it, because had the police taken me away or taken me down to the police station and had me drop my drawers, every single one of those kids would have been put in DCFS, would have been picked up by DCFS and put in foster care. I gained nothing by doing the right thing my whole life. And I don't mean the right thing by not reporting it. No, I reported this. I told over 100 people. but trying in my daily life to do right, trying to have integrity and morals, and to treat people the way I want to be treated, to feed homeless men even when I didn't have money, to turn in lost wallets even when I didn't have money, to help grandmothers cross the street, not for a tip or for a pat on the back, but because it's what I believe. You help a senior citizen cross the street. You give up your seat to a woman on the bus. I didn't learn this from Jan and Art. They're fucking savages. They're mentally ill psychopaths, as are their kids. I had manners. I was a gentleman. And in the end, I will end up dying right after my 36th birthday, having been in poverty my whole life, and having been subjected to over 1,000 traumas, and no one once came to my aid but my fiance. What was the point? What was the point? I go through my days, and I say this literally like a Tourette's response, dozens of times a day, or when I'm laying in bed, I say, what was the point of my life, of doing what was right, of surviving unthinkable trauma, pain, violence, torture, and abuse, and not having it color me in the way I saw the world? What was the point of creating all this beautiful photojournalism work and all of this writing and having 6 novels done and 18 photo exhibits and 185 blog posts that we're ready to share? What was the point? And that's just nothing. I've got a ton more work. I can't tell you how much work I created despite all the pain I felt. And then being attacked, how lazy I was and what a piece of shit I was by all these people who were trying to kill me, who had never once contributed anything positive to society, let alone they had no talents except stealing money from people or harming people or victimizing people. That was their talent. They were the best at that in the world. I was the best survivor in the world. As I said, you can look at the photo of me. You can look in my eyes and you can say, this is a man who had love in his heart. My fiance said to me, she said, you have the strength of 1,000 men and you have the love of 10,000 men in your heart. We will go on to greatness together. There is nothing you can't do after surviving your past. And then what's the worst case scenario that could happen? She dies of cancer at the age of 39. And I have to return to the most dangerous, violent psychopaths I ever met, who encouraged me to commit suicide and come at me violently just days after her death. Does anyone realize what I have survived through? No, you can never know, even reading that letter. Even if it was 1,000 pages or 10,000 pages, you would never understand. To have the family I do was the single greatest curse in history, because they are all 5 of the most mentally ill, dangerous psychopaths in history, and they all need to be locked up. All need to be pulled off the streets today. That is justice for Aaron. But what was the point? What was the point of my life? I died no longer having faith in this world. Because after my soulmate dies, you lose all faith. To come back and have 8 family members wish me death, direct and extended family, to have the trauma psychologist, Jennifer, not even call me back when she knows and she got my text message and my voicemails. What kind of evil exists in this world that was just so drawn to me? I know darkness wants to kill lightness, but how much more was I supposed to endure? How much more love was I supposed to have in my heart? How much more was I supposed to have to try and do the right thing and make the world better? And how many more people did I need to tell before someone did the right thing? No one ever did. The only person who did was the only woman who died in my life. You know how many people I wish had died? Had Art died in 1990? God, they would have stopped it. I didn't just have one parent who was a violent psychopath. I had 2, both of them, Jan and Art. She was violent towards me hundreds of times. Hundreds of times. She did this thing where she would dig her nails into you until you bled. She'd do it in the back of your neck, or she would do it under your armpit, or she would do it on your arm. And I don't think I ever had a 2-week period in my entire childhood where I didn't have a scab on my arm from this. She was the most psychologically destructive person I've ever met. She would destroy you. She knew what to say to make you cry, even as a little kid. But she told me, not even 2 weeks after my fiance died, to go out and get a job, to get over myself. If you want to die, Aaron, just do it. You're an adult. No, I'm going to a movie. I don't want to talk to you. I don't care if you commit suicide. This was my biological mother. And my biological father was even worse. How did I get so lucky to have 2 of the most destructive, violent forces of nature raise me? And then how do I turn out the way I did? How, when I go somewhere, do people say to me, wow, you're such a nice guy, you're so well-mannered, you're so easy to like? If you had met me Those of you listening to this who don't know me and didn't get a chance to know me, you would say, we would love to have had him over for dinner. It would have been a great conversation, a lot of travel stories. And I was probably the easiest guy on the planet to get along with. Yet, the Wulf members, this family, are the most destructive force of nature, and they were never stopped, and they're still alive. This was not an issue of, well, you know, the weak get slaughtered by the strong. I was the strongest man in history. I could take out 3 men coming at me at one time and put them all in the hospital, and I'm still left standing. That was my strength. I can endure hundreds of beatings and not cry, because if I cry, Jane Art would just hit me 3 times harder and longer. For what? They were never stopped. Nancy and Ron had photos in early 1991 and didn't report it. What was the point? What was the point of running to my neighbor's houses covered in choke marks if they never called the police? What was the point of the police coming to the house and then blaming the 14-year-old kid, the 15-year-old kid? What was the point of my teachers knowing about the violence and everyone in Northbrook knowing about the violence and no one reporting it? Okay, fine, so I survived to 18. Great, get away from the house. It's exactly the plan. Never see those assholes again. Well, what happened? They took all that money I made. Equivalency of $250,000 in today's earnings. They used it. They leveraged it to make millions. Made them filthy rich. Kept their son in poverty. I couldn't pay my rent. I told her I was going to get an attorney to get that money, and he laughed at me. He said, good luck, no one's going to touch you without money. Guess what? No one would touch me without money. I couldn't get away from them no matter what. Every job I had, well, you know, it was hard for me to keep a job when you have complex PTSD and your developmental skills and your foundation are screwed up. I had one of the highest IQs on the planet, but what was the point? I could not study and still get straight A's, despite the fact that I had more trauma than any child in that school combined. They never championed me. They never supported me. They destroyed my whole childhood. Put me into acting, where I couldn't play baseball as little league as a kid. I couldn't go to birthday parties. I lost my whole summers, where they dragged me out to L.A. trying to get rich off of me. And when I didn't perform well enough, they beat me nearly to death in front of people. What was the point? What was the point of succeeding immensely as a kid, where Fortune 500 companies were lining up to put me in their ads, and their radio ads, and their print ads, and in their commercials, and their national commercials, to make all that money, to have them steal it all, and to keep me in poverty my whole life? But meanwhile, they've given millions of dollars to Stacy, Seth, and Zachary. Paid all their bills. Seth has never worked. He's never held a job. He's the most unemployable fool on the planet. And he can attack me and tell me what a fuck-up and failure I am? I was the greatest success in history for someone who came from my past. And the saddest thing is that you were reading my suicide letter that you got, if you were listening to this audio. And that was the only thing I ever got to publish. That was my memoir. That was not my plan. I had 6 books, nonfiction, about my travel adventures, but also certain books on how to help make society better, directly related to what I overcame. Never got to publish them. What was the point of having this work? Doing this work in unthinkable pain and trauma while being violently attacked and destroyed psychologically and financially and professionally by my own family, let alone the other predators that were around me? What was the point of doing all that? Doing all that work for it never to get to see the light of day, because the love of my life and the only family I ever had and the single greatest human being I ever met dies of cancer before I can even put a ring on her finger. Where was the justice there? Where was God there? I don't believe in God. Trust me, I died not believing in God. I look back to my life and say, how could all of this have gone so wrong? How much time did I waste praying to God for things to get better? And they never did. Not a single person ever did their job. The number of doctors who did not report, the number of attorneys who did not do their job, the number of police officers that ignored the cries of a child, the number of teachers and coaches who knew about the violence and did nothing. It is astounding. It has never happened in history. Do you know why? Because that kid commits suicide at the age of 10 or 15 or 20 and is done. I survived all that only to die right after my 36th birthday. For what? What was the point of living? What was the point of my life? Why did this have to happen to me? Any religious figure who wants to tell me that God is good and God exists, I say, read my letter. Tell me God is good and God exists. Evil won, make no mistake about it. Evil won. Jan and Art were never stopped. They committed hundreds and hundreds of felonies against me, both violent and financial. They were never stopped. And all along, Nancy and Ron, great aunt and uncle in Skokie, didn't even bother doing anything with those photos, and then attacked me violently over the phone for questioning them. I said to Nancy, "How many traumas have you had in your life?" She's 64. She said, "Well, you know, I lost, you know, my parents, and that was sad and everything." I'm like, "No, that's grieving. How many traumas have you had where someone actually threatened your life and you felt you were going to die?" And she paused. She said, "You know, I don't think I've had any." I'm like, "You know what? By the age of 5, I had more traumas than you had in 64 years. Do you know how many more I had?" And then I get attacked for asking why they didn't do anything with the photos. It is hard for me not to have such anger at them. And then to be violently attacked over the phone by Ron just a few days ago. It's just unfathomable that someone would treat someone like this, knowing that they knew I lost my fiance. They knew I was very near death. They knew Jan and Art were threatening my life. They knew I was tying up my affairs and writing this letter and preparing the legal cases, and the mental illness of those two to do this to me. It proved my point. They would never have done the right thing. Not even cowardly. They are evil to their core. Every single person around me was evil. Every family member around me was evil. All of the extended family. No one did their job. Everyone saw the violence. No one cared. What kind of friend to Jan and Art, and some of these people have been friends with them for decades, what kind of friend can witness Art beat the living shit out of a 5, 6, 7-year-old boy in front of them and then stay friends with them? There are several people that I sent my letter to. And I said, "This is the people. These are the people you chose to be friends with for 30 years, 40 years. What is wrong with you? They're all mentally ill. I'm sorry, if someone's beating their kid in front of me, you know the first thing I do, besides not be their friend? I beat the crap out of the father. I stop the man and protect the kid, because that's what you do." The number of men I had to stop while traveling overseas to protect women who are being attacked is astounding. The number of times I put myself in harm's way to protect the weak is astounding. I didn't do it for a reward. I never got a reward. Truthfully, I got punched a few times too. But you know what? I did what was right. I protected someone who needed help, and I was strong enough to handle it. I don't care how hard the punch was. It didn't kill me. What was the point? I can assure you no one in my family would have done one of the things I did, let alone the thousands of things I did to make this world better. And then I die. I die. I die in poverty. I die in terrible health because I cannot afford the health care that I needed. I died on Medicaid. I died on Medicaid after having appendectomy surgery because Jan and Art said, "Don't give them our address," despite the fact you're staying in our fancy home. "Don't give them our address because we're not paying for this," when they have millions of dollars in the bank and they were responsible for the destruction of my life. They took that childhood acting money and used it to pay therapy bills for me. I saw the ledgers. I saw one ledger that Art actually sent me, and it's in my letter. Who does that to a child? You rob him of his childhood. He makes a fortune. You use that money to buy real estate at 3% down, put a tenant in, get passive income, rinse and repeat. Then he was able to offset his earnings as an attorney, because he never did very well in the beginning, with my earnings. Could save himself $75,000 a year in taxes with what I earned. He made a fortune off of me. And then he uses that money to pay for the therapy that he caused. But they will go to their graves along with their 3 mentally ill children blaming me that this was all my fault. PTSD and complex PTSD, it doesn't fall out of the sky like rain. It doesn't just happen. It doesn't come from nowhere. It comes from a source, and the root of that was Jan and Art. They destroyed my life. I never made excuses. I never sat there whining, complaining. The same way my friend from a decade ago said, "I didn't know any of this." No one did. I had girlfriends who didn't have a clue. I had friends even longer that didn't have a clue. They're going to read my letter and they're going to say, "I had no idea. I didn't know even 1% of this." That's how well I hid it. And I was told I was traumatic and I was the problem and I was emotional. Bullshit. Every single interaction that Jan and Art and their kids have with anyone is toxic drama or is related to some criminal activity. The number of lawsuits that are going on with them right now is astounding. It's astounding. The number of people Art, Jan, and Zachary are cheating financially and the crimes they're committing. I saw the files. It's astounding. These are criminals. How have they never been stopped? You know why? Because I've died saying crime pays. Crime 100% pays. I died because of these people, because of what they did, because they were never stopped. What was the point of my life? What was the point of my life? I had such incredible plans with my nonprofit. Well, it was going to be called the Aaron Wulf Foundation because I'm Aaron Wulf. And there were three pillars to that. Three pillars. One of them was protecting abused children. One of them was protecting battered women. And one of them was giving people access to clean food who needed help. And for the children, my plan was to provide scholarships to technical schools for these kids who are orphans. The way it was through Mike Rowe's foundation from Dirty Jobs. He's got Mike Rowe Works. It's his foundation. My fiance and I had all the plans. I had several hundred pages of notes specifically lining out how we were going to do this. These kids needed a hand up, not a handout. They deserve to have help that I never got as a kid. And if I could get them into a technical school and within 3 years they could be making 100 grand for these jobs that needed to be filled and they had no one to fill, that kid for the rest of his life could make a living, get married, have a family, and provide for them instead of winding up in prison. Mike Rowe is 100% right with what he's doing. The other part of that, by the way, was Cal Ripken Jr., the foundation in honor of his father, the Cal Ripken Sr. Foundation. I was specifically wanting to have a grant that I gave to Cal every year to do background checks on teachers or coaches for organizations or schools that could not afford to do background checks. That's part one. Part two was building shelters for battered women so that they and their kids could have a safe place to go. And I want to do this all around the country and truthfully the globe as well. And the third part was to team up with local farmers because I got into gardening and naturopathic medicine and horticulture the last several years. This changed my life. This changed my life. Being in the garden and just being connecting with Mother Nature and having my feet and hands in the soil. So we were going to team up with local farmers and help them do high yield farming techniques through Israeli methods that my fiance and I had studied. And then when they get an extra 30% yield, we would have them donate to the local shelter so that the families in town who needed food and clean food, organic food, could have access to this food. That was my foundation, my nonprofit, the Aaron Wulf Foundation. The number of people I could have helped. I'm not talking thousands. I was hoping to help hundreds of thousands or millions. I was hoping when my books did so well and my fine arts sold so well and the other business that I had built and ready to go did so well in my publishing platform, I could give millions every year to these things. Why wouldn't I? I survived my past. I had love in my heart. Why did I need to hold all this money? I didn't need to. This was in my DNA from birth, despite the fact being raised by the two most evil people on the planet, and I never lost it until I died. This was what I wanted to do for society and the world, along with thousands of other plans that you'll never get to know about. No one protected me. No one stopped Jan and Art Wolf. If they had just stopped those two, forget the other predators, they had just stopped those two and stopped them from committing the violence and the torture and the financial crimes to destroy my life where I couldn't get on my feet no matter what. If someone would have stopped them, and I reached out to over a dozen attorneys over the years, no one would stop them, even when I had all the evidence. The evidence you're seeing in my letter, I've had evidence like that for all of my cases. I've spent hundreds of hours sometimes prepping legal cases for attorneys only to have them tell me, oh, it's too complicated or we're full. No one wanted to help me. Medical professionals didn't want to honor their duty to report, and attorneys didn't want to do their job. And I had a biological father who was the greatest criminal in history. He was never stopped. He's 69, still going. I guarantee you, he has harmed more people than anyone on the planet. More than a warlord. More than a warlord. Never stopped. You're listening to this because I'm dead. You're reading my letter because I'm dead. 50,000 pages of my writing that I planned to share. Not all of it. I wasn't going to share with you all my journals. But the ironic thing is, as someone who is incredibly private, because of the pain I felt from my past, it's the most revealing thing I ever wrote. And it's the most revealing thing anyone in my past combined would ever know about me. And it's for all of you to read. And why did I do that? So we can get justice for Aaron. It would have been so much better if we got justice for Aaron when I was alive and I begged for help. I could have changed this world. My fiance could have changed this world. The most loving, compassionate, brilliant, elegant, sophisticated, worldly woman. Incredible woman. My entire life was worst case scenario. Why? Why? I was not a weak man. I was the strongest man in history. I could diffuse a situation just with an intense look overseas when men were eyeing my camera gear and I'm in an impoverished place and there are four of them or five of them or six of them. They knew, don't mess with this man. It's not going to end well for us. I could handle any amount of torture and violence and abuse and threats and sleep deprivation or starvation. I could function with nothing and still create great work, and still keep my optimism. But what was the point? What was the point? I never got a moment, a day that was quiet, because my wiring in my DNA, because of Jan and Art, as I say in my letter, which of these things don't belong in the sentence for a kindergartner? Sesame Street, Mr. Rogers, and complex PTSD, they were all the same to me. It's all I knew. I go into a restaurant. I'm always facing out. Always watching, scanning. I could be on a date with a beautiful girl across from me. I could be completely present in her mind, looking at her, listening to everything she's saying. But in the corner of my eye, I know where everyone is in the restaurant. I know instantaneously, without even looking, what could be the thing that could be used as the weapon to hurt the person the most and how to use it without studying this. I knew exactly how to take a person out instantaneously. Why? Well, that's what happens when you have hundreds of events of violence against you as a little child. It is ingrained in your DNA. I could be the most loving, compassionate, caring man. And I was. 99% of people never saw anything else. Because that's who I was. But in harm's way, within a second, I could switch. It was fight or flight every day. And as I say in my letter, I was never allowed to take the flight route. I always had to fight. Even as a five-year-old kid, I'm the master at fight. I'm the master at war. My situational awareness and my instincts and my survival skills and my physical strength and my intensity. I guarantee you, top 0.01% on the planet. I didn't want those skills. I wanted a calm, quiet, loving life with the love of my life, with the woman I plan to be married to for the next 60 years. And I could put all that aside. But you know what? When you travel the globe as a photojournalist, you know what? That's when it came in handy. When I go into an area and my camera gear is equivalent to 10 years of their earnings, well, it's good to be able to have survival instincts and situational awareness and street smarts and strength, or even a look diffuses a situation. Great, that helps me as a photojournalist. It didn't affect the rest of my life. I handled it pretty damn well. The people who know me will say, you know what? You're the highest functioning complex PTSD trauma survivor in history. I could walk into a room with 100 people and leave with 99 acquaintances and make people laugh and charm them. Not in a serial killer kind of way, but genuinely because I loved people. I cared about people. I liked people. I liked to make people happy and to make sure they were comfortable. People pleaser? Yeah, I tried to keep it in perspective, though. Fortunately, the people who were closest to me were the people who were the greatest predators. I always chose the wrong relationships and the wrong advice and wrong friendships, and that's just the result of a terrible foundation, not knowing who is healthy and who is not. Because I could instantaneously, within a half a second, assess a person whether they were a physical threat to me or not. I could walk into a room with hundreds of people and tell you exactly who in that room had violent tendencies just by looking in their eyes in a half a second. And I guarantee you I was right probably 98% of the time. I had better training than any of these special ops soldiers who've been doing this for decades, because this is in my foundation as a little kid. Threat assessment, I was one of the best in the world. Great. What about the rest of you who have lived to the age of 40, 50, 60, 70, and you don't have any traumas? You didn't need to have that skill of survival instincts and threat assessment. I did. That's how I survived this long. No matter who was trying to kill me, I could outthink them. And be ready for whatever they were doing. And one of the greatest deficits I had as a kid, because of the destruction from all the violence and the trauma and literally being born right into this complex PTSD, is that I could not do sequencing. If you had to put together a model airplane, couldn't do it. It was impossible. I could not know how to follow those directions, because my upbringing caused me to only be able to think one step ahead. If this person's coming at me this way, I have to do this. If he's going to try and harm me this way, I have to do this. I did not get to see, okay, the next two steps after he does this is this. So things like that, I got lost, even in my own neighborhood, growing up. I made the joke that I got lost in one of those big refrigerator boxes as a kid because I was terrible with directions. And you know, it was kind of true. All over the world, even with a map, I couldn't read a map. I couldn't understand how that worked. And people look at me like, I don't understand how you can travel the world as a photojournalist and not know how to get where you're going. No, I was the guy that would stop for directions 15 times to go 1 mile. I remember I went on a date once at 16, and this was before cell phones, before GPS, and you have the directions written down, but I got lost, and I stopped for directions, and she said, oh, you're not like other guys, you stop for directions. I'm like, yeah. And then I stopped for directions the second time, because I forgot what the first person said, and then by the third time, she's saying, this was not a good idea. And next time, she drove. But the point is that sequencing or abstract thinking or critical thinking, these were things I could not do. Because for a child who is exposed to that level of violence, you are the master at survival. You are the master at war. And a child should be able to learn developmentally like everyone else. I mean, I shouldn't have had those deficits. I was still extremely smart. I still did very well in school. I still learned incredible skills very quickly. I could reverse engineer things very well if I had a template, if I could see someone do it. But I could not read the directions and make sense of it my whole life. I could not put things together if I had to build something. Absolutely not. And that's a tangible deficit that affected me in everything that I did. I knew if I had to drive somewhere, even with a map or even with GPS, I had to allot another half hour. And I was always early no matter where I went, because I made sure that I gave myself time to get lost, because it's pretty much a guarantee. And that's not the kind of thing a kid should have to deal with, but that is what I had to deal with, and much, much more. So to be attacked for not being able to do specific things, and like Jeff Golub, who pretended to be a father figure, but he was one of the most sadistic, violent psychopaths that I ever met as well, I mean, who destroyed me. It's like, you have brain damage, you're an idiot, how could you fuck up all the time? And I'm like, I don't know, I just assumed he was right. I just assumed I was a fuck-up and a failure because this noble man whose two sons have never made a living and he still pays their bills to the age of 40, he was telling me I was stupid. It didn't matter I knew I was exceptionally smart. It didn't matter that I knew I could get straight A's without studying. It didn't matter that I knew I could learn really advanced skills extremely quickly and break them down in my own system. And I had to develop my own system for this. I couldn't follow how the teacher taught, but I could teach myself. And my whole life I had to teach myself. And that's just how it was. That's how I adapted, and that's how I coped. And that was as a result of my upbringing. And I didn't realize this wasn't normal until my fiance explained all this to me. And she said, you do these things because of this. And did you notice you do this as a result of this? And I said, I don't understand. And she says, here's what your past did to you concretely. And she could break it down. This is causing this problem, which is causing this problem. But if we can address the root here with this problem, we can take care of those other things. And here's a blueprint. Here's how we're going to do this. Follow this blueprint, and we'll work through this every single day for this specific issue here, and we'll get this better. And you will be able to put this one aside, and it's never going to be an issue again. And she did that. This loving woman did that for thousands of things over 3 years. You will never know, because you will never get to see the tangible end result of what this woman did to make me a better man in every single way. The most patient, kind, loving, nurturing woman in history. As I say in my letter, I received a level of love and compassion and time from this woman that only five men, or not probably not even five men on the planet, can relate to and understand. She wasn't just the love of my life. She wasn't just my best friend. She wasn't just my only family member. She wasn't just my business partner. She wasn't just the person I admired and respect the most in my entire life. This woman was literally everything to me. She was my soulmate in every single way. To have this gift come to me at the age of 32 and a half, after everything that had come before, after all the predators I had before, after all the father figures and the terrible best friends and the terrible relationships I was in and the terrible advice I got, that was always designed in some way, shape, or form to harm me. I was around predators no matter what I did. Healthy people hang out with healthy people because they know what healthy is. Sick people hang out with sick people. And you know what? Usually in those relationships, one person's a predator and one person's the one that's, you know, was the abuse victim. I hate using that word, victim. I never saw myself as a victim. But to meet someone who could literally dissect everything that had happened and understand my past. And what was the point going to these therapists in 45-minute sessions? And they're looking at their watch or they're falling asleep on me. Spectre fell asleep on me 3 times. And I can tell you which days they were because I put it in my notes. He fell asleep during my sessions, and I'd say to him, are you okay? He's like, yeah. I said, your eyes are closed. He said, I'm listening. I had another therapist say, I'm just resting my eyes. I'm like, you fucking asshole. You're being paid how many hundreds of dollars an hour, and you can't even be present? Why go into this profession if you're going to hear this toxic crap all day long, if you're not going to try to help people? And that's something I never really understood, why people go into certain professions like this. I know there are loving people who genuinely want to help people, but I met a lot of doctors who didn't, who did it because it's a good title and a fancy job with a lot of money, and they had no interest in actually helping other people. And that's a scary thing. So to meet a woman who understood me intrinsically, who was the first person in my entire life, and the only person, now that you're listening to this and I am dead, she was the only person, my fiance, in my entire life, whoever understood me, who understood who I was, what was in my heart, what I wanted to do in this world, everything, knew everything I had built and what to do with it. And she said, you're thinking huge, great. Let's think even bigger. You can change the world. Here's how we'll do it together. We would have changed the world. I cannot be any clearer to you. And we would have loved to have done it. She was the most generous person I ever met. She was the most generous person I ever met. And she has to pass at 39? Why, when the evil all around me is still alive and they've never once been stopped, how can there be a God? How can there be a God? Why are we trading loving, kind, caring, compassionate people who have genuine desire to make this world better and do for people who literally are destroying the world and burning down villages and are full-blown psychopaths and committing crimes and the police won't even stop them? What's the point? I say in my letter, 15% of this world just is, they're hellraisers. They destroy the world. They rape and pillage and burn everything down. 80% of the world is in the middle and they're passive sheep, or they do nothing to make concrete steps to make things better. And then there's 5% of people who say, you know what? Today I'm going to make the world better and here's how I'm going to do it. Here are my plans. I'm not going to sit there and pray for it. And here's what we're going to do to make things better for everyone and ourselves. Because I don't think you should just do it for everyone. I think you should do it for yourself as well. You should be able to, it should be mutually beneficial, your relationships, instead of take, 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 like the 15%. Jan, Art, Stacey, Seth, and Zachary, their adopted felon, David, Jeff Golub, these people take, 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 take. Stu Snow, take, take, take. Spectre, take, take, take. Janet Farrell, take, take, take. Daniel Halpern, take, take, take. A lot of the teachers at Glenbrook North and the deans who didn't do anything, take, take, take. Who that I mentioned in my letter was saying, I'm going to make this world better? None of them. None of them. They were in the 15% or in the 80%. Who listening to this will look in the mirror tonight and say, I'm in the 5%, and here's why. I can tell you tangibly why I am in that 5% to make this world a better place and what I am doing to do that and what is in my heart. You know who those people are? They're the people who have love in their heart and compassion in their soul, and you could see it in their eyes. Someone, you're at the grocery store and you see someone and they smile and they brighten your day. Just by their smile, they're in that 5%. You don't have to go building a nonprofit that helps millions of people. You could just be the person that walks down the street and smiles at people. I was that guy. I didn't have the money to do the nonprofit. I didn't have the money to, you know, feed every homeless person I wanted to. But if I had $5 in my wallet, you better believe I'd do it. The times when I had just $5 in my wallet and I needed food and I gave it to someone else, I did that because I felt God would protect me and make this better for me, and he never fucking did. What was the point? What was the point of trying to always do right for my life to end at just after 36 in the worst pain in history? What was the point? Why did crime pay my whole life, but love and compassion and intelligence and strength did not? Why did I create all of this work that could have entertained the world or enlightened the world or opened people's eyes to what was around the rest of the world? What was the point of being able to go into a remote village in India or a remote village in Turkey or in an impoverished area in Cuba and to be around no one who spoke English, but to have these people invite me into their homes and to sit me down and to pour me a cup of tea and to communicate with just their hand gestures or to get the one person in the village who could speak English to translate? And I'd sit there for an hour and talk to them and smile, and they'd smile back at me. And I'd take their photos, and I'd take photos of them in their home, and I'd get their story. And then I write those things down to create these, you know, these incredible travel adventures and things that I experienced to share with all of you. What was the point of doing all of that? I had another 300 plus easily blog posts that were in development that I hadn't finished editing. I'm talking hundreds of thousands of words here that I had ready to launch alone. There were 250,000 words that were ready to launch. I never got to do it. The reason I traveled was because I constantly needed this different change of scenery. I hated being around my biological family. I tried to leave them at all costs. If I could get a couple grand, I'd get on a plane and travel cheaply and travel in remote areas. And it wasn't expensive, but I could have experiences every day that changed my life. And to share these stories with you, to meet incredible people and to see incredible things and to experience life-changing events, and to be able to capture it. I wasn't just a photojournalist. I didn't just take pretty photos. I was able to write and make you feel like you were there. I honestly believed, and maybe, well, you're listening to it and I'm dead, maybe I'm the biggest idiot on the planet. I honestly believed I would live to be the age of 100 with my soulmate. That's what I believed. I said, I have to die first, a week before you, and you can tie things up after me. And she says, why do you get to die first? And she died first. She died before I got to put a ring on her finger. She died before we got to begin the rest of our lives. For what? Why did I always try to do what was right for this world and for other people and for myself and have these healthy habits if I never got the chance to take the first step forward? Why did no one help me? Why do I reach out to Janet Farrell years ago, begging for help with violent nightmares that were destroying me? And she's dismissive. It's trauma that we treated before, and it will resolve itself. This was 6 months after she had treated me. This woman thought she could heal me in 1 week of sessions. And I'm not talking like intense sessions. It might be an hour and a half, 2 hour session for a couple days. It wasn't 10 hours of sessions a day. She thought in 1 week she could treat all my trauma. She claimed to treat all of Jan and Art's violence, over 1,000 events of trauma in 25 minutes, based on the notes and the recordings of the sessions, because she allowed me to record them. 25 minutes, this woman thought she could handle the things that you read in my letter, or you will read in my letter. Who do you know who survived through 10 events of trauma? Who do you know who survived through 100? Who do you know who survived through 500? Who do you know who survived through over 1,000? I'm well over 1,000, make no mistake about it. This woman thought she could just box everything Janitor ever did over 30 plus years and do it in 25 minutes with her voodoo. She was the worst psychologist in history, but not only that, she's the deadliest doctor I ever met. She's the deadliest doctor. Jeffrey Spector didn't report sexual abuse or violence, make no mistake about it, nor did other doctors. Janet Farrell left me to die. These nightmares took over. I don't know how many of you had violent nightmares or how often you've had them, Do you know what it's like to have up to 8 violent nightmares per night? Every night on a loop and it doesn't stop? Where you have 3, 4, 5 men coming at you with knives or bats or guns or pipes and they're trying to kill you and you have to disarm every single one of those men on your own with just your hands. And you have to fight to your death to ensure you can get away. The number of nightmares I had where I was literally covered in gallons of blood from other men defending my life. I was never the one in the nightmare attacking them. They would always come at me when I'd be in public. It was worse than any Quentin Tarantino film. Take the goriest film you've ever seen. And I could never watch his films. It just was too much for me. I loved the show Dexter. I thought Michael C. Hall was incredible. I loved that notion of, you know what? The only way to fight evil is with evil. It was brilliant. It was brilliant. But I had to stop watching because it gave me nightmares. As incredible as he was, as incredible as that show was, I couldn't, because that was my life. That violence was my life. And to have these nightmares where every hour on the hour I'd wake up screaming, thinking I'm covered in gallons of blood, only to realize it was just a nightmare and I've sweated through the sheets and my heart is pounding so fast, I can't go back to sleep. Do you know what kind of torture that is? For a man who has as much love in my heart as I do? Do you know how hard that is for a woman to be next to a man when she's seeing him be tortured when he sleeps? And do you know how hard it is for that man and that woman to have gone to a doctor and said, please, please help me with these nightmares, and she dismisses them? Who is this evil woman, Janet Farrell? She deserves the death penalty for what she did to me. She ignored my nightmares repeatedly. I begged her for help. She wouldn't do it. I showed up even the year later because I was out of the country, came back to her. And I said, I've had all this trauma. I don't want to hear about your trauma. We already treated it. We're not dealing with that. I said, you don't understand what I've been through. I've been through it. She said, I don't want to hear it. Here's what we're going to do. I'm gasping and I'm telling this story and it happened to me. Who is this woman that gets to decide what I do in my sessions? Who is this woman to tell me I healed your trauma. I healed your PTSD 2 years before, 3 years before. This isn't PTSD anymore. We've healed that. She just waved her magic wand and sprinkled some fairy dust and it just went away. I don't understand the mental illness and the psychopathic behavior that this woman had to think that this is normal and this is how you treat a patient. She does not get to tell me when my trauma is done. I do. But the funniest thing is, all the other psychologists before in my past would have me talk them out and rehash it out. And that is traumatizing in itself. It's not really effective. Although if you tell it one time, that's fine. But what they do with PTSD at the Veterans Affairs, they have you tell the story over and over and over again until you burn it out of your mind. And that's the worst thing in the world because it's been proven that doesn't work. But Janet Farrell wouldn't even let me tell her the trauma of what happened. Give me a one-line sentence of what happened. Okay, here's how we're going to treat it. And she would do this voodoo stuff. EMDR works for PTSD. It does. If you have a few traumas. It does not work on childhood trauma. It's been proven. It's in my letter based on the peer-reviewed study that I included. And there's more research on that as well. So for her to claim that she can heal my complex PTSD in 1 week, it's astounding. That is criminal. That is evil. That is the deadliest doctor in history. And then when I come back begging for help with nightmares, that'll resolve itself. And when I come back wanting to talk about the other trauma that had happened, you don't know. We're not talking about that. No, you're healed. Why did I go back to her? Because I was desperate and begging for help. It is hard to find a doctor you can trust. Do you know what? At the end of the day, I never had a doctor I could trust, and I never had a doctor help me. I had two therapists. Actually, I will correct that statement. Two men in their 50s, in my 20s, who were very kind, calm, strong men. And I responded very well to those men. You know why? Because I wished my biological father was kind, calm, and strong instead of violent and evil, and sadistic, and a psychopath. But what is a doctor supposed to do with someone like me? Well, they're supposed to invest in that patient the way the patient is investing in that doctor. It's supposed to be a mutual exchange of value. I'm giving you money, you're to treat me. You're to take care of me and help me get better. And here are my problems, and you tell me how to fix them. And those two men were good, but you know, what happens when you're raised the way I was? I moved 27 times in the last decade of my life. I moved 27 times in the last decade of my life. I'm talking full moves. I'm talking you get a U-Haul and you pack your boxes up and you take them to the next place. And then when you're ready to move again, you get the truck again and you do it all over again. I had a girlfriend who said to me after 6 months, she said, "You haven't unpacked your boxes yet. What are you doing?" I said, "I haven't unpacked in the last 8 years. I don't unpack. I live out of boxes. This is how unsettled I was inside. I never felt safe anywhere. I never felt safe anywhere. I know people who have lived in the same home for 20 years. I don't know what that's like. Those people had calm, quiet lives. I guarantee you they didn't have 3 traumas in 20 years. I guarantee you they had good biological parents or good parents. They don't call them biological parents. I always refer to Jan and Art as my biological parents. And I always refer to Seth and Zachary as my biological siblings, because that's all they were. All it was a mutual bloodline. They never had my back. And if anything, they tried to kill me. So to know that certain people are still in the same home 20 years later, 30 years later, that is astounding to me. I can't comprehend what that is like. Anytime I'd go somewhere and I'd move in, there were times I'd move into an apartment and I'm like, shit, the neighbor next door is out of control. There's an airport nearby. I needed it quiet. I needed library quiet in order to sleep or to feel safe. I never signed year leases. I didn't sign 6-month leases. I signed month to month. This was my life. Jan and Art never gave me the opportunity to feel safe for even a day in my life, and I will end up dying, as I said, under the same conditions that I was raised and forced to live in as a child, trapped in a room, fearing for his life to come out. I'm one of the strongest men on the planet physically. I'm in such frail health, despite how my voice sounds now, that I don't trust them for a second not to try to kill me again. Because these arts already tried since I've come back. I never asked for their money. I never asked for their help. I just asked for them to stop trying to kill me, to stop trying to destroy me, stop trying to ruin my life. And oh, by the way, could you give me the money that I earned? No. When I came back in January, or when I faced them in January, because I came back the month before, and they left me in this house for 22 days to die on my own while my fiancé was dying as well. And they stayed on their luxury vacation that whole time. And I told Jan the poverty I was in and the starvation that I had gone through and how horrific that was. She smirked at me and she said, "Oh, we had a Vanguard account with $8,000 in it. We didn't know how to get it to you." I can't tell you the pain in my chest when she said that with that smirk on her face. Because in September 2012, as I said in my letter, I had specifically ordered Art in writing to surrender all accounts to me. All financial accounts, any physical property, anything. And guess what? He never did, even as my attorney. He didn't care. Fuck you, Aaron. I don't care. So to have Jan say this solely to torture me, knowing what I've come through, knowing my fiance died days before, knowing that she did this and got off on this, she enjoyed this. This is the mental illness of this woman. Do you think $8,000 would have broken their bank? No. These people travel for $50,000 a year, you know. They have millions in the bank and their son, they've kept their son in poverty his whole life. And I want to qualify that statement. They didn't keep me in poverty. I chose to take certain steps to make a better life for myself. Yes, that was my responsibility. My past should not have shaped me, no matter how terrible it was. And I had these skills. But every time I tried to launch a project, or any time I tried to do a business, and I didn't have $500 to launch the business, it's really hard. But the saddest thing is, in the end, I had everything built, and I couldn't even launch it. You cannot launch a business with nothing. I taught myself marketing. I taught myself every component of marketing on my own. I had to learn all of these skills. I had to learn the skills of 20 people, because I couldn't afford to hire anyone, let alone myself. And I would do it, and then I would fail. And then they would tell me what a fuck-up and failure I was and what a loser I was and how I would never amount to anything. And Art told me, you should go get a job as a gym teacher at the elementary school down the street because that's all you'll ever amount to. I was the kid who made more than any other kid on the planet. And he's telling this to his kid who he destroyed, but he's given millions to every one of his other kids to launch businesses or buy businesses. Seth has been given a fortune. He's never made a living. He's destroyed every business he's ever built. Over a dozen. None of them ever made money. Stacy, she doesn't make any money. Arch has had her, helped her sue her previous employer for taking a Jewish holiday off that she intentionally planned to defraud the company for religious discrimination. You better believe he happily lined up to get her that money. That's what she's living off of. His own son gets death and rape threats by Daniel Halperin and gets attacked. He doesn't sue GBN. His own son tells him that Stu Snow molested him and Art is on the school board and is an attorney. He doesn't sue GBN. There are 50 of those stories. I have them all written down. I have the evidence of what happened. I even lost a job after university that it was very dear to me. And I worked very hard to get. The first day on the job, worst case scenario, my bad luck. One of the female managers starts massaging me inappropriately. I asked her to stop. She keeps going, I ask her to stop. Well, what happened after that? She made my life hell, and I was fired weeks later, despite the fact that my coworkers right there, they gave me written statements confirming, yes, she had inappropriately touched him, and this was sexual harassment. Art wouldn't sue. He just wrote a letter and then left it be. Couldn't get a job for the next 6 months. I had to move back home with Jan and Art, and they tortured me all over again. And they tell me what a fucking failure I am. What is the point of having a father as an attorney? And he could have made millions off of me with the things that happened. Just suing bad people who had done bad things to me. And he never once did, because he did not care who tried to destroy me and kill me. But for his other kids, he had spent thousands and thousands of hours getting them out of every single crime they've ever done. The number of times those boys, Seth and Zachary, were arrested or gotten into trouble or public intoxication or the number of business partners Zachary has ripped off intentionally, it is astounding. And Art will stop at nothing to help them. The same way that he stopped at nothing to help David Wolfson, a.k.a. David Wolf. Thousands and thousands of hours and hundreds of thousands of dollars in legal fees he paid for David to keep David out of prison, despite the fact that David and his father stole $16 million from investors intentionally. David has committed more felonies than anyone I've ever met. And Art got him the best attorneys and worked as his attorney as well and did everything to champion this complete con artist and felon to help him. And oh, by the way, while his son is starving to death and can't afford medical treatment, at the same time he got David a nearly $300,000 mortgage for a new property. Because David couldn't get the mortgage because David has a $751,000 lien against him by the Securities Exchange Commission and the federal government for cheating investors out of money because he was found guilty of this crime. So Jan and Art will break the law to protect him and get a mortgage in their name for him. But they get a mortgage in my name with my good credit and will not pay that $1,400 mortgage that was theirs, telling me we don't have any money while they're taking a trip the next month that's $25,000 around the world. And they sink it in my name. They commit foreclosure fraud in my name. Forces me into bankruptcy. This was all intentional, trying to destroy me. I never made excuses. This is the thing. I never made excuses. I said, I'm going to build a better life. I'm going to work harder. I'm going to work smarter. I'm going to work faster. I'm going to do this. I was the only one in this family who had healthy habits. I was the only one in this family that cared about making the world a better place and actually loved people. But it wasn't just, oh, I'm just going to love people and just work for on a mission. No. I want to build great work, and I want people to love my work, and I want people to see that it's valuable to them, and I want there to be an exchange of value, and they give me money for the work that I put out. They get something out of it, I get something out of it. Great, that's a great career. It was all built and ready to go. I just needed help with this complex PTSD. I needed help to stop the nightmares, and they took over. No one would help me, even a professional. Art will give millions to all those kids. You watch what they do over the next 40 years. They will never do anything of value. Because they're all criminals. They're all mentally ill psychopaths, and that's the thing. But yet, his only child who actually could have made the world better and had the skills to do it and the talent to do it, despite what I came through, the only one who had a genuine smile and love in his heart. He was intent on destroying me to the end, literally violently charging at me days after my fiance died. Literally encouraging me to commit suicide. 5 minutes after I have appendectomy surgery, we get in the car after surgery. He attacks me in the car violently. Tells me I'm a burden, just kill myself already. And I have to defend myself, screaming. Well, I just had my abdomen cut open. I bled through my shirt, protecting myself. And Jan said, you always did trigger him. It's your fault. I didn't have one parent who was mentally ill psychopath. I had two parents, and they never stopped. And no, by the way, they had three kids who were mentally ill psychopaths, and then they adopted, legally adopted, let him change his name, David, a fourth psychopath. Do you understand what it's like to have all of this evil permeating in one place? All I tried to do is get away. I just wanted to get away. How do you get away when you can't get on your feet and you're dealing with things that no one else can understand? And you're building things, but then you're constantly having them torn down and told what a fuck up and a failure you are. I could walk into a room and be the most confident man in that room, but inside, my confidence was shattered. And that's the reality of it. There was an outside me and there was an inside me. And how do you solve certain problems when you can't do sequencing and you can't do critical thinking or you can't do abstract thinking? My fiance tried to teach me these things. She made me so much better. Someone said to me after she passed, why don't you honor her and go on? I said, I honor her by dying. I honor her by not going on because she was the only one for me. The Hebrew word is besheret. It's meant to be. She was my besheret in every way. I was her besheret in every way. I don't go on. That's how I honor her. I'm choosing death because I don't value this world anymore because this world never valued me. This world never protected me. How many hundreds of times did I have to ask for help to have one person take me seriously besides her? She was the only one. She was the greatest human being in the world. Before she died, I said to her, you are my hero. I want you to know that. Hero is a person who, you know, jumps into a river and saves someone one time. They're called a hero. You are my hero. You saved my life. You saved my life when I was struggling. And she said, you are worth it. I know you'll get better. And then she was dead. What was the point of my life, of meeting this woman, this angel, the angel of all angels? What was the point? If my life was going to be so hard and it was going to be worst case scenario and it never stopped, did I not deserve better? Did I not deserve at least one person to stand up and say, I'm going to help you, Aaron, besides her? And again, to show you the level of evil I faced, Nancy and Ron Janis blamed me for not reporting the violence when they had those photos. I don't know if you can grasp after reading my letter what that could have happened if that had been reported in early 1991. Those photos were given to the police or to DCFS. It's a 2-minute phone call. Or please come over here. I have some evidence of child abuse. That alone puts people in prison for a decade. That stops the violence. I'm not telling you that bad things don't happen in foster care. Trust me, that was part of one of the books I was writing about overcoming and about child abuse and the sexual abuse and all that. There are some really bad foster parents that do some terrible things to those kids. So don't think that foster care is always the answer. It's not. But do you think if Nancy and Ron loved me that much to take these photos that they would have adopted me? You know what Nancy said to me in March 2016? She said, we would have loved to have taken you in. We would have loved to have been your parents. We loved you so much. And I cried. I'm like, oh my God, this could have been. And she knew I was going to die. She knew I was finishing up this letter and the legal cases and several other things, and then I was gone. She knew this was it. And she says this to me, and it makes me cry. And then I start thinking, what if it had been different? And then I say, finally, a couple of days ago in April here, why didn't you report it? What the hell were you thinking? Not her consequences, right? We don't want you to die, Aaron. We want you to go on. Well, why didn't you want to protect me when I was 10 years old and you had this evidence? How much more evil can I face? How many more people can intentionally choose to do the wrong thing? How many more people in Northbrook had to see me get beaten and not do anything? And I don't want to harp on, you know, oh, the beatings destroyed me. I mean, I had some acquaintances and I had some in the past, whose fathers were bad men who did bad things to them, because they would tell me, and I'd bite my tongue, because I tried to never judge someone with the pain that they were going through, because it was their pain, and they had a right to feel that pain, even though no one in my family or the father figures I had ever gave me that opportunity to feel my pain or to acknowledge my pain, let alone to allow me to grieve after my soulmate dies. But I would listen to these men tell these stories that destroy their lives. Terrible fathers destroy children's lives. It's a fire that never stops burning. It just destroys everything for generations. It's the most destructive force of nature, bad parenting, which is why I wrote so many articles about this and blog posts for my site. And some of you will get the opportunity to read a few of those if you've gotten them. I'm leaving three behind and destroying the rest. The point is, these men would tell these stories, and I'd see their tears. And the stories they told, while bad, were not nearly as bad as what I went through. But it destroyed their lives. And these men were never able to get on their feet. And I felt terrible. But then I said to myself, why am I not shattered by this in the way they are? Oh, I'm shattered by it in different ways. I can create 25 years worth of work in a decade, but then not figure out how just to publish despite everything being done. I fear being attacked for my work so much that I never put it out, because I was attacked by everyone around me so much just for being me. I was attacked by Jan and Art for being a failure. Jan said he always had all these problems. He always was the problematic child. Who do you think causes these problems? And by the way, I was not a problematic child. If you watch my childhood acting reel or you see photos of me as a kid, that is the sweetest, most loving child on the planet. I was always blamed for their crimes. Same, this is what predators do. They bring weak people around them, or they bring people who survive through terrible things who don't understand, wait, this person's bad news. And I didn't. I mean, as I said in my letter, I could immediately assess if someone was a violent threat, and I was almost guaranteed to be right. But I cannot assess if someone is saying they loved me if they genuinely meant it. One of the greatest deficits I ever had throughout my lifetime that never, ever got filled was this need to feel loved. And I say in the letter, basically, the way a person would need air to breathe, I needed love to fill the holes in my heart. And I would choose the wrong relationships, or the wrong girlfriends, or the wrong father figures, or, you know, other friendships, thinking, wait, this person cares about me. No, they didn't. I had very few people in my entire life who had my best interests at heart in just a general sense, and only one person who truly, genuinely loved me. That was my soulmate. Why would I go on? You can say, well, Aaron, you sound like you're doing okay. You sound like you're strong. You sound like you've got a sharp mind. You've got all these plans. You built all these things. You could share this with the world. The pain I have from losing her is the greatest pain of my life, because you could combine the other 1,000+ traumas and they don't hurt as much as this one. So if you want to talk about what breaks a man, this broke me. This broke me and this shattered me, and I knew I would never recover. And that was okay with me, because I was not going forward without her. I deserve the right to have a happy and loving marriage and future, and to be a positive contributor to society. When I needed money for food or medical care, Jan and Art had an account with $8,000 in my name, and they laugh at me when they tell me that. I asked Art in January, can I get that account? And he laughed at me and says, no, you're fucked. And then Jan tells all her friends how unhappy I am in this house when they're intentionally holding me hostage and wanting me to die in front of them. They literally wanted me to die in front of them. I had no strength left after what happened to me in the end. And then to lose the love of my life, my best friend, the woman who was everything to me, no. The amount of physical pain I am in from my injuries is astounding. But the amount of pain in my heart and the amount of grief in my heart is unlike anything I've ever felt. And then to have to have full-blown complex PTSD here in this house with these predators, and then to have them threatening my life and encouraging me to commit suicide and then being stuck in bed while trying to do the work of 100 people to wrap this up. Do you know how much work it is to do a legal, to prep a legal case with the evidence and to make sure that it's completely clear? Because here's the thing. Most people will prep it, and then the person gets the file and says, okay, I got a question about this part. What does this mean? And you can clarify. I'm going to be dead. There can be no outstanding questions left. I must think through every single thing the person on the other end and the government agency is going to ask and try and solve that. And oh, by the way, it's not just one case. It's 4+. And oh, by the way, I've got a 200+ suicide letter with evidence that's just exhausting to put in. And oh, by the way, I want to share some of my last photojournalism images and make sure that there's a video of that so you can see who I am. Because the wolves will say, he was crazy. He was evil. He was a terrible man. You can hear this recording and you can listen to my voice and you can see a photo of me and you can say, that man was loving. You are all fucking crazy. I thought I'd have an incredible legacy. I did not plan for it to end like this. To have looked death in the eyes as many times as I did. Nothing could kill me. Nothing could kill me. No amount of torture, no amount of violence, no amount of sleep deprivation, no amount of starvation, no amount of death or rape threats or violent attacks. Nothing could stop me. Nothing could kill me. It's proof I'm still alive. The only way I die is at my own hands. So be it. At any point in time, someone could have stood up and done the right thing. You cannot read my letter and say, that was the most cursed man in history. You can't not say that. You can't not say this was worst case scenario his whole life. And oh, by the way, that's not even 1% of the story. It's not even fair. You read that letter and to think that you know what I went through. You don't. How does a man not lose his smile and the love in his heart? How? I don't know. All I was told my whole life by everyone but my fiance is what a piece of shit I was and what a failure I was and how I had no talent and how I'll never succeed. And the two people who said it the most were the two people who raised me, who stole all this money, who destroyed my childhood with violence but also working me like a circus monkey. I mean, I'm in this house right now of theirs. They're gone right now, which is why I can do this recording. They're back in Northbrook. I was able to come out of the bedroom for the first time in 3 months. No joke. 3 months. And not fear that I was going to get killed. And that's why I was able to do this. Why I'm able to talk candidly and not quietly. Every phone call I had, for the few that I had, I have to whisper to the person, letting them know that they're threatening my life and trying to kill me when I'm just trying to wrap up my life and these legal cases and this letter and the other things and then be gone. They would not even let me die in peace. They would not give me a day to grieve after losing my soulmate. How evil can two people be? Jan and Art Wolf and their kids have broken all records. Justice for Aaron means every one of them are rounded up today and put in prison. Society will be better. I promise you, I guarantee it. Society would have been better if I was championed by at least one other person who would have saved me. The number of people I reached out to after her death, asking for help, who basically told me, die already, like Zachary did, is astounding. I included his text messages so you could see this is what my brother did, the brother that I risked my life for, the brother who I took more beatings for in 1 week than he got in his entire lifetime. That's how he talks to me. The brother I almost literally died for when I severed my leg in half and almost bled to death in front of him when I was 20. This is what he says to me. Well, what caused that? There was no fight. I just didn't respond after he was viciously tearing me apart and attacking me for being the fuck up and the failure who couldn't get his life together when, oh, he'd just gotten $350,000 from Art for his business. The rules were always different for me with all of these people. Make no mistake about it. They could destroy the world and they could try to beat you to death, but then it was your fault for crying or getting blood on the carpeting. And again, I always felt this was my fault. I carried this burden, which is why I never complained. Until I meet my fiance. And she says, this wasn't your fault. Are you kidding? Why would you think that? I said, well, look, here are the notes from these conversations I've had. Hundreds of conversations. They've all said the same thing. As Seth said, we all feel this way about you. You're the one that's wrong. We wouldn't all agree unless you were the problem. Aaron, clearly, Seth Wulf, the beacon of wisdom and sanity. I don't know how to convey to you what it feels like in someone's heart who for 32 plus years is told this was all his fault, all of it. And then to meet a person who says, no, none of this was your fault. Are you kidding? Why would you ever believe that? Here's why it's not your fault. Here's what they did. Here's how it affected you. Here's how we fix this. Here's how we go on to greatness and we never look back. The problem is I look back. I look back a lot. Because it registered in my head, uh-oh. Some people did some very terrible things to me. And that really caused massive problems for me inside. It was an unintended consequence. You know, there are people who say, you know, just sweep it under the rug. Don't deal with it. Just leave it. Go forward. Don't look back. And that's what my journals always were for me. I'm in that moment. I'm dealing with that trauma or that grief, and I'm writing how I'm feeling to get it out, because there was no one else to talk to and no one else to help me, so I had to help myself. And I would write for an hour or 2 hours or 4 hours, and in the end, I was writing for probably sometimes 7 hours straight. I would not get up from that chair or go to the bathroom, have a sip of water until I was done getting this pain out of my heart. That was my rule. You do not get up from this chair. I don't care if it's 50 pages in a journal, no joke, until you have emptied that pain in your heart for this moment. You can come back in 20 minutes, fine, but you do not get to get up until you are done. And I'd be done, and usually it would help for several days. All that writing, all that time, just trying to deal with the pain since I was 15 years old, do you know what I could have been doing if I did not have that pain and that trauma and the additional traumas because of Jan and Art and all the people that they pushed me onto who are terrible pedophiles or father figures who harm me more? Do you know what I could have been doing if I had been raised in a healthy home and not spent all that time writing 20,000 type pages of journals trying to cope? I wrote travel adventures and I'd sit there writing for hours and, you know, on the photos that I took and the notes and the people that I met during that day. I loved that. Oh, that was exciting. That was the stuff I couldn't wait to share with all of you. And I don't think for a second that it's not a bad thing to be introspective and say, why am I feeling this? What happened? How do I make sense of this? How can I break this pattern? Or why does this keep happening? And that was the purpose of my journals. That's how I became a great writer. I did not need to spend the number of hours it took to write 20,000 pages of typed journals over 20 years to cope what I could have done to change the world in that time. What I could have done if the trauma had stopped at any point in time. They were never stopped. I died before Jan and Art. They lived double. Art lived double my life, plus however long he goes. That man will probably live to be 100. You watch. I said in my letter, they're worse than the Black Plague. They will not die. I was the only one in this family who wasn't insane. I was the only one in this family who was not mentally ill. I was the only one in this family who had love in his heart. I was the only one in this family who was likable. You know, by the way, not in a, we're going to be nice to this person and fool them and then be violent towards this other person over here within 30 seconds later. The people who think Jan and Art are nice people are people who are mentally ill. They're people who clearly have issues judging another person's character. And oh, by the way, they're all passive betas. As I say in my letter, I broke their pattern. I broke why certain people are allowed in Jan and Art's life and other people are not. Alphas are not allowed in their life, make no mistake about it. They have this force field, this evil spell that they cast over all of their friends who will happily line up to do favors for them and to be taken advantage of and to be their foot soldiers to poison everyone else. Whatever Jan says, people do. But only the passive betas they bring around them. Alphas don't tolerate that shit. I was the strongest alpha you'd ever meet. You don't survive my past if you're not. No one survives my past, truthfully. No one lives to 10, let alone 15 or 20. What was the point of my life to lasting right over the age of 36? What was the point? I never got to share my work with you. I never got to show you my smile that wasn't in a photo I've left behind. I never got to do my nonprofit. I never got to get married to the love of my life. I never got to travel to the countries that I planned and to meet the people that I'd wanted to meet and to have money in my pocket and to never worry, you know, when will I eat? Instead, I die under the worst of conditions and the worst of health with the worst pain and a family wishing me death. Does anyone listening to this think I am evil? Just hearing this alone? No sane person does. You can't. Normal people are good judges of character. Evil people are not. I deserve to live to 100. Do you know how many millions of people's lives I could have changed? Do you know the plans I had just even during my struggles, let alone when I would have gotten better? With the love of my life at my side? Do you know what I could have done with one healthy year? Or when I could have healed my physical injuries finally? I was never going to heal them permanently, no. Or completely, no. I deserve not to be in pain every day, though. I deserve to be able to try and touch my toes. Whatever it costs, I don't care if I had to go to physical therapy 5 days a week for a year. I deserve that right. But yet the people who cause these injuries and this violence and the pain never once in 35 years ever apologized for it. It was always my fault. It was always my fault. The troubles I had getting on my feet were my fault, despite the fact that I was the only sane one in the family, and I tolerated more trauma than anyone in history, let alone they had 10,000 kids combined. But their other three kids, no matter what failures they get into, and everything they do is a failure, everything they touch is destroyed. They've never been able to hold jobs or keep jobs. They've never not been able to commit crimes or rip people off or commit fraud or harm people. Anything they do is justified. This is what it means to be a targeted child. I was targeted not just by Jan and not just by Art, but by every one of their kids. Even Zachary, the one who I would have died for happily, because that's how loyal I was to him. It's one of my greatest traits that one of my friends said. He said, "You're the most loyal person I ever met. You would literally take a bullet for people who would never take one for you." I never even got that chance to take that bullet for someone. I have to take my own bullet. I deserve better. I deserved so much better. No one did the right thing but the love of my life. I will have died hating this world, make no mistake about it. I will have died having no faith in humanity, because the only person who was ever worth having faith in was her. I don't know what the lesson is in all of this. I'm dead. You're listening to this because I'm dead. You're not listening to an audiobook of mine, which I had several that I was planning on releasing with my travel adventures, narrating great things that I was experiencing overseas or afterward. I didn't get to share those things with you. I didn't get to have you put my fine art photography on your wall. That was my dream, is to have tens of thousands of people around the globe taking my photos. Every day I could be out there as a photojournalist in a foreign country and come back with winning shots. I wasn't one of these guys who had to shoot 10,000 images and pick three. I could shoot 15 images and 9 of them were fantastic. And it's not me patting myself on the back. It's the reality. I knew how to shoot. And you never got to hang my photos on your wall. because every time I tried to sell my work, I hated it instead. This was Jan and Art's legacy, destroying their only child who had talent and love in his heart. You never got to read my books. You never got to read my blog posts. You never got to see the videos of me from overseas that I shot. I had so many planned, ready to roll. Well, Aaron, you could go on. You don't have to. No, you don't understand what I've lost. You don't understand what I've been through. You don't understand the pain I'm feeling. You don't understand how many people I asked for help just after my soulmate died who said no. Well, Aaron, you're asking the wrong people for help. Everyone I ever asked for help said no or didn't help. I'm not willing to start all over. I guarantee you 100% I will never meet a woman even 1% as great as my soulmate. What's the point of settling for the 99th best when I had the single best and she's gone? What's the point? There is no point. I knew as soon as she passed, I knew within minutes I was done. And I deserve that right to have wrapped this up as quickly as possible, but here I am. 3+ months later, I'm still not done. Because I can't just die in peace. I have to be tortured by Jan and Art and have them be violent towards me and encourage my death. I can't just die in peace and write a one-page letter. No, because the horrors of my life and the crimes that were committed against me and the horrific thing people did to me, that covers tens of thousands of pages. Why spend all this time gathering all this evidence, factual evidence I can hold up in court proving these crimes, to just die because I'm in pain, because that's what I deserve? No, I deserve justice while I was alive, but I will get justice when I'm dead. And every day is painful. You will never understand. It's hard enough when someone loses a best friend. It's hard enough when someone loses a girlfriend or loses a fiance or loses their wife or husband. What happens when you lose all of that and that person is your actual soulmate? The truest definition of what a soulmate is. Do you know the pain I wake up in every morning? My heart pounds so hard. The bed vibrates. I'm gasping for air. It takes me hours to calm down. I take my calming herbs. Kava kava, valerian root, pumpkin seed, to try and calm down. Those herbs work for people who have panic or anxiety. They're not meant for a man who's going through what I'm going through. I can't just write you a one-page letter. I've got to write you an entire novel. I can't just write you that novel and be done. No, I've got to prep 4+ legal cases. This is my life. It's always been a dozen wars at a time. People are like, you're dramatic. No, if you knew 1% of what I was going through, you would say, how are you even functioning? How are you even standing? How are you even smiling? How are you even creating this great work? How are you even able to love anyone but yourself? The number of people who read my letter after I'm gone who knew me, they'll shake their heads saying, we had no idea. I never made excuses for my past. I never complained and whined about it. I just wanted a better life, and I was willing to work at it no matter how long it took, no matter how many hours in a day or how many days in a row or weeks in a row without a day off. I was willing to do it, and I had to do it with no money. Well, battling nightmares or battling health ailments and complex PTSD and battling people who are around me who are trying to kill me with their ideas and their attacks. Never made excuses. My fiance changed everything. She literally opened up the world to me. She showed me everything I could have and everything I didn't have. Do you know what a gift that is? Do you know what a blessing that is for a man who came from what I did? None of you listening to this can understand what I came from and what I came through. And I accept that. I don't expect you to. I don't expect you to read my letter and understand what I came through. For many of you, it'll give you PTSD alone. I'd be like, this was the single worst life in history to a man who deserved the exact opposite. That's my point. Where was God? Why did this happen to me? What did I do to deserve this? Absolutely nothing. And oh, by the way, why were none of these predators and even evil people stopped? Do you know how many people I told about Stu Snow? No one did anything. He's still out there. Guess what? As soon as my letter winds up in your hand, someone's going to call up and action's going to be taken. He's going to be rounded up. But watch him die shortly afterward. This is what these guys usually do. Ken Lay from Enron commits all these terrible crimes. Wouldn't he have a heart attack before he was wound up in prison? That's convenient, right? I don't get it. I will die with more unanswered questions than questions that were answered. And that's the worst part. I don't know what day I'm going to be done. I hoped I had been done several months ago, and this pain could have been ended, and this could all have just been done. The letter literally has taken on a life of its own and gotten out of control, and I'm doing it all on my own while grieving and in pain and fear for my life. So what I'm battling is something that you can never understand. But every day I ask more questions to whoever I'm asking those questions to up above and to myself and to the love of my life, saying, why did this happen? What was the point of my life? What did I do to deserve this? What did I do wrong? What more could I have done? What could I have done differently? I try to always put it on myself. What could I have done differently? Instead of, wait a second, what could other people have done differently? What could Nancy and Ron Janis have done differently in early 1991 with those photos? What could any of my neighbors have done at any point in time reporting the violence? What could Northbrook police have done at any point in time when they showed up at the house all of those times and I'm begging for help? What could Jeffrey Spector have done when I reported the violence or Stu Snow? What could any of the teachers have done when I reported the violence or the death threats by Daniel Halpern? What could any of the family, extended family who saw this stuff, or the friends of Jan and Art done if they had reported the violence? How could that have changed my life? Oh, wait, what about my friends' parents? What about my siblings' friends' parents? What about the people at the public pool or at the sports fields who knew Art was out of control? What if any of those people had spoken up? What if any of my coaches had spoken up? What if any of the other doctors who knew have spoken up? How many more people do I need to give you an example of to tell you how terribly I got fucked? It's a literal definition of it. For what? I still charged on, making a great life. No excuses. Everyone else, they did their thing. I'm doing mine. I am not accountable for what they did. I'm accountable for my behavior. I can't change what they've done. I can only change my life. What other new habits am I going to choose that are going to be healthier for me and make me stronger and better? What new skills can I learn that will help me succeed professionally and personally and emotionally, but also help the world as well? My success should have been a guarantee after what I came through, after the skills I had, after my ability to deal with people properly and to not be like Jan and Art and the rest of their kids. And then my success should have been absolutely guaranteed, undeniably, with the love of my life at my side, who literally was the key to 10,000 of my locks, the puzzle to my peace, my bookend, and me for her as well. Should have been a guarantee. This is the saddest story in history. It's the most devastating ending in history. It's the most disappointing love story in history. Because had a few things gone differently, we would have had the happiest, most successful, healthiest lives of anyone you ever met. And so I'm in April now. And every day I'm thinking about these things. And it is torture, make no mistake about it. I'm being tortured, trying to make sense of this. But there's no way to make sense of this. This is all senseless. I keep asking myself, what could I have done differently? What if I'd done this? How can I fix this? Is this all just one terrible nightmare and I'm in a coma? And then I'm going to wake up And she's going to be standing right there in the hospital with tears coming down her face, saying, he's finally awake again. Do you know how many times I've asked myself aloud, is this just a nightmare? Am I in a coma? Will I come out of this? Is that the reality of it? But I know it's not. Because I look to my side, and I have her favorite red hoodie. And I said, why is her red hoodie here? Her sweatshirt, if she's not here. And every night, I sleep with that red hoodie next to me. I take the sleeve, and I drape it over my heart. And where her hand would be, I place my hand on top of it. And I beg her to come back. I beg for things to be different. The same way my whole life, I begged for things to be different. But in this time, I know they'll never be different. You know, someone said to me as a kid when I got upset about something, how much will this matter in 10 years? Guess what? I don't have 10 years. And this matters. And this is permanent. This doesn't get fixed. This doesn't get undone. There's no redo. There's no second chance. Crime paid. Crime paid because no one would do their job. Even the people who are paid to stop the crime, the Northbrook police are the biggest criminals you'll ever meet. The greatest thing that's going to happen from this for all of you in Northbrook is that that police department's going to be investigated, and ideally several people's heads are put on platters. Didn't help me. How could a kid be wrong? Isn't that the rule? You listen to the underage kid? The kid can't possibly be the troublemaker. Kid, are you being beaten? They didn't ask me that. I said, I'm being beaten. Look at these marks. What are you doing? And I didn't say it in that tone. I said it with tears in my eyes. How many more bruises do I need to show you guys? I was never big for my age. I'm 5'8", 150 pounds. I mean, in Asia, I'm sure I'm towering, right? I'm the Yao Ming. But no, I've got normal Jewish genes. Never cared about my height. I knew my strength and the way I carried myself. I could be 6'4". So I was not a big kid. And I'm actually curious how much of my... Was I stunted with my growth because of the injuries? Did that developmentally affect me? Could I have gotten to 5'9", the average male height, had I had 10 less beatings? I don't know. I'm just genuinely wondering. The point is the police didn't listen to me. They didn't listen to the kid crying. They didn't listen to the kid covered in marks, welts, bruises, choke marks. Really? I'll tell you something. You know who had the greatest life in history? Jan and Art Wolf. They committed thousands of violent crimes, not to mention the financial crimes on the side. They never once got stopped, never once got arrested, never once were put in prison. And oh, by the way, they destroyed their son's life, stole his childhood, worked him to death. And because I was so talented and cute and likable and smart, I got all those jobs. I could learn a 5-page script as a 7-year-old overnight. Jan would record it on an audio cassette and play it back to me, and I could memorize it. That's how I memorized it, because I couldn't read the lines. Great, so I was so good that I was the only kid they had that worked all of the time. None of the other kids worked. I made them all that money. Great, what a reward, right? Lose my childhood, make that money, get beaten when I don't get jobs, beaten when I do get jobs. They take that money, they make a great life for themselves financially, and destroy my life. Didn't make excuses, kept going forward. I'm not going to be like them. Whatever they do, I'm going to do the exact opposite. That was my stance. Just look at the behavior of the rest of those kids, if any of you get the chance to see them in the future. Watch how they behave. Watch how they act. Watch the looks on their faces. It's the face of evil. I'm sorry, those of you listening to this who have never met me, I'm sorry you never got a chance. I would have loved to have met you. I would have loved to have smiled at you and shaken your hand and say, it's a pleasure to meet you, because I would have meant it. The pleasure would have been mine. I didn't get that pleasure because I'm dead now. How many more people could I have given love to? To have at least one more person give love back to me. I never try to feel sorry for myself. But I have to be honest with you. Knowing my death is coming up and I know it's guaranteed, I'll tell you, I feel sorry for myself. And rightfully so. Because there's no fixing this. There's no redo. I can't undo what has happened. If she had still been alive, my fiance, I could have gotten through anything. You could stab me 100 times, I would have survived it. I could have been run over by a semi-truck while walking outside, I would have survived it. A plane could have crashed with 200 people on it, I would have walked away as the only one. Make no mistake about it, the number of near-death experiences I've had just overseas alone, with guns pulled on me, or knives, or surrounded by men, or packs of rabid dogs trying to bite me and attack me, walking through houses filled with landmines, getting hit by a car on the side of a mountain with a 200-foot drop down, being pulled off a bus claiming that I'm a terrorist in Montenegro because I have a beard, missed 6 bombings in the Middle East right where I was at. I mean, I have over 100 of these stories written down that I was planning to share with you. You're listening to this now and I'm dead, and you're saying, Aaron, why didn't you leave him behind? No. Why didn't anyone stand up for me? Why didn't not only no one stand up for me, but why was I the only one standing up for me and then having to fight all these forces of evil on my own, even as a little kid? How much stronger could I be? I was the strongest man in history, make no mistake about it. I survived through things no one else in history would ever have survived through. For what? What was the point of my life? To have created all this work, to have had all these plans to make the world better, to have the love of my life at my side, to have everything built and ready to roll. To finally know how to live a healthy life and to succeed and to never look back and to have it all end. I don't understand what happened to my life, how this happened, why this happened, why this never ended. There are things that have happened since the beginning of this year alone that if you knew those stories and the things that had happened, you'd say, what the hell? You're a lightning rod. Be sitting in that room, trapped in there. Things are happening that you will never understand because you don't know. Where was God? Who was I supposed to be praying to? I stopped praying. Make no mistake about it. Stop saying this, something in the sky is going to help me. The only thing God ever did was ensure I never died during all of those events. I'll tell you one thing. I didn't die, no matter what happened to me. I died at my hands. That's not a reward. The number of people who have lived full lives and had just 1 or 2 traumas or none is in the overwhelming majority. I was cursed, right? Worst case scenario, being raised into this family with these psychopaths. And they never stopped. I would have loved to have been gone after high school and never come back, but you know, how do you get on your feet? When every job you have a hard time keeping. Or you're battling with full-blown complex PTSD and it's hard to get out of bed. And oh, by the way, you can't afford medical care because they're keeping your money, but also they're bleeding you out while giving all your siblings a fortune. How hard do you think it is for Stacy, Seth, and Zachary to survive not doing anything when all their bills are being paid for or they're being funded in millions? How hard do you think it was for me to survive? Battling everything that had come before it, everything that was going on then, and everything that was going on after from these psychopaths. All I can do is shake my head and just sigh. Because it doesn't make any sense. It doesn't make any sense. And that's the worst part. Because I could always come up with an answer that would at least settle the sadness in my heart or the pain in my heart or the fear I had. I'd sit down and I'd write in those journals and I would not get up until I had an answer that was suitable for me. Not naive, but a pragmatic answer, why did this happen? How did this happen? How to stop this from happening again? And oh, by the way, in almost 100% of those journals, I took 100% of the fault. Well, it's easy to come up with a solution, right? It was my fault. Here's how I make sure it doesn't happen again. No, I'm at fault for what I do, not at fault for what the evil people around me did. And that was something that only stopped when I met the love of my life. There's no answer that can calm that panic down when I wake up. There's no answer that can calm that panic down when I wake up in the middle of the night with a nightmare, a violent nightmare. And those haven't stopped. What is the point of reaching out to Janet Farrell in January, shortly after I lose the love of my life, begging for her help, and having her tell me, well, if you're going to kill yourself, I can't treat you. Which, by the way, violated the law. Well, if you have nothing to go on for, then there's nothing more for me to talk to you about. Violated the law. And then, oh, okay, if you're willing to go on, I'll treat you. And then I call her the next day after Jan encourages my death. And she doesn't ever call me back again. I call her again a few days later, begging for help. She doesn't ever call me back. This cycle never ended. It's impossible for you listening to this to wrap your head around it. All you can say is, if you really are pragmatic and sane, you'll say, he had the most cursed life in history. How could a man so loving and caring and so kind with such a warm voice have not gotten the benefit of the doubt or been helped by anyone? And the proof is in the outcome. Jan and Art were never arrested. Snow was never caught. Spectre was never put in prison. My siblings were never stopped. Halpern was never stopped. Northbrook police never were arrested for what they did. Nancy and Ron never had any consequences to it. Not reporting that violence in 1991. Who got all of the consequences to all of that evil, even when I begged for help? I got 100% of it. I got 100% of the consequences for my choices in life and 100% of everyone else's. And this is not a world I want to live in. Absolutely not. For those of you I didn't get to meet, for those of you I wanted to help, I'm sorry. I'm sorry I never got that chance. But the people around me, the people who knew me, the people who had a legal obligation to protect me, they never did their job. The only person who ever tried to help was the love of my life. And as I said, going on without her, absolutely not. No one has a right to tell me that. I choose that. The answer is not, well, at least his pain is finally over. No. I had a right to have a good life. I had a right to have a day of calmness and peace and happiness and success. I had a right to share my work with you, not with 50 guns pointed at me while fighting 12 wars against 1,000 men on my own. And oh, by the way, I still did that. I still fought those wars, and I still beat all those men to save my life. I still created great work despite that, or in spite of that. For what? I fought more wars to survive by the age of 5 than any of you listening to this ever had. I guess all I can say is, for those of you who are early in your lives, I hope you have a long and healthy one and a happy one. For those of you who are at the end of your lives, I hope you had a long and happy and healthy one. And for those of you who are in the middle of your lives, I hope you too have a long and happy and healthy one. I did not have a long life. I did not have a happy life. I did not have a healthy life. I never made excuses for it. I did the work to get better, to get stronger, to get smarter, and to be successful. I never had a chance. It shouldn't have been this way. It should never have been this way. And instead, it was this way. and to die with these unanswered questions, and to know my death is coming, despite all the times I fought off death and all the people who wanted me dead. There is no peace or solace in my heart about this now. I literally wake up every day saying, please have the strength to have 6 hours to get this work done, so every day I can do less and be gone. Some days, they're not good days, make no mistake about it. I don't have time to grieve. I've never been able to take a day to grieve over losing my soulmate. It's, I have to get this done. Either today I'm focusing on this legal case or these two legal cases, or today I'm focusing just on the letter. And oh, by the way, if I'm having terrible panic and my heart is racing and I'm feeling pain, what else can I do that can distract me from the tedious work that requires my greatest focus? What can I do instead? I am juggling things that a team of 100 people wouldn't be able to juggle. I'm doing it on my own. Who here thinks I deserve to die in peace? I didn't get to. I die not being able to make sense of any of this. I've destroyed a lot of my physical work already. Journals, notebooks, things like that. Photos. I was the most sentimental person you ever met. You would ever met. Because I'm gone now. Photographs as a kid. I mean, I started photographing at the age of 14. All these memories. I have every love letter every girl ever gave me from the age of 15 on. I still have them. Why? Sentimental. I didn't read them. They would just be filed away, you know, in a folder. I have all those things. I have all the little post-it notes that girlfriends would leave for me. Went out to the grocery store, I'll be back later. Or, love you and hope you have a good day. The morning note that's left at my bed. None of these women affected me and influenced me the way my soulmate did. It's not their fault. It's how the relationship was. Very few people get the opportunity to meet that one person who literally changes their life. But I have all of these things. Every trip I ever took, I have my plane tickets, and I have my notebooks of the people I met, or I have my receipts from my hotels that are sentimental, or the restaurants. You know, I have all the birthday cards that past friends sent me, even when I was a little kid. I saved these things because these were memories that mattered to me. My journal, sadly, was the place for my sad memories. And the sentimental things I kept were the things that were the happier memories. But to destroy all those things, truthfully, they didn't matter. It didn't matter. What mattered was the love of my life. What mattered was being able to live the life that I deserved. The life that I had intentionally built brick by brick on top of a shattered foundation to make my life better and to make the world better. It's just incredible what I had planned, what I had built, how I thought things would have gone. And I ask myself every day, why couldn't I just have died as a kid and stopped this pain then? Why couldn't I have died in any one of 100 near-death car accidents I've had around the world? India alone, I almost died 30 times. Semi-trucks coming at me in the wrong lane. My driver trying to run us off the road and we go into a ditch. The number of times that happened, it happened 3 times. But the number of times I was in a car with someone crazy who was driving through red light intersections with cars in them, not caring. I mean, India was crazy. That was my first memoir I was going to release. You would have loved it. It was a travel adventure. It was a love story. It was a coming of age. It was the worst trip of my life, make no mistake about it. It was hell from the very beginning. Right when I touched down, 45 minutes in, get into the car and I had the craziest driver you'll ever hear about, but you won't get to hear that story, even though that blog post is done. You won't get to read it. It's one of the ones I'm destroying. That story, that journey changed my life. I was literally kind of reborn there in India. And I came back with plans to completely change everything. And I did. Then I meet the love of my life shortly thereafter. It's not a coincidence. It's Basharat. We built everything for the greatest life, the happiest life, the healthiest life, the greatest marriage. She said to me, I've never laughed so much before I met you. And every day, one of the greatest joys for me was making her laugh, hearing her giggle. And it was even the times when I was doing something that I didn't even know was funny and she'd laugh from the other room. She'd hear me singing some song or doing some impression of some old Jewish grandmother from Brooklyn that I'd always do named Judy Goldberg. She loved Judy Goldberg. Could always make her laugh. Judy had a mind of her own, but I always knew that would make her laugh. You know what it's like as a man to be able to make the woman you love laugh? It's the greatest gift in the world. Comedians know that. They get that, you know, rush of adrenaline and energy. It's the greatest gift. But to be able to do that to the woman you're going to marry and the woman who's going to be at your side for the next 60 years, knowing every day I could give her that joy, wow. I'll never get that chance again. I don't know what more to say. I could talk to you for probably 20 hours and still not make sense of this. I could talk to you for 2,000 hours and not make sense of this. People who get cancer, terminal cancer, and they know they're going to die, and they have 10 months, 6 months, 4 months, 2 months. I know you don't know officially when you're going to die, but the doctors tell you, you got 6 months. I can imagine what they feel, or they've felt, is what I'm feeling now. Because I know this has an ending. The faster I can get that work done, the faster I can be gone, the faster my pain can be done, the faster this is just all over. But to be doing this alone, without the love of my life, knowing this is how it all ends, again, it leaves me with so many unanswered questions. And I can tell you with absolute certainty, they are the most painful questions you'll ever know. What was the point of my life? Why did this happen? Why did this keep happening? Why did not one person do their job? Why did no one care? How many more people did I need to ask for help? What did I do to deserve this? Why did Jan and Art never stop trying to kill me, along with their kids? What could I have done differently? What more could I have done to be better, to be stronger, to be healthier, to be more successful? None of it matters now. Because I don't get to go forward and fix this. I know this is the end. And to not be able to solve those things, to not be able to have answers to those things, after the life I lived, trying to do right, trying to keep love in my heart, no matter what. I just want to be done as fast as I can and have all of these terrible memories, just have them all in. This is the saddest story in history for the strongest man in history who overcame or survived through the worst pain in history, who had plans to change this world and make this world better, and to have the greatest life with the greatest love at his side, and it all ended and none of it happened. My survival was for nothing. My plans were for nothing. The work I created was for nothing. And I cannot grasp that. I cannot have solace and calmness in my heart thinking about that. It's the most tragic life in history. Because had I succeeded, it would be the greatest story in history. The greatest success story, the greatest story of overcoming. And again, I wasn't just sitting there praying for rain. It was all built, ready to roll, to share with all of you. All of my work, all of my plans, the nonprofit, what I wanted to do, the plans to travel the world and bring all these incredible stories to you of the people that I met, the things that I saw, and the places that I went. To bring that to you back in the comfort of your home. What's Aaron up to today? Where is he at? Oh, did you read his new story? He met this villager in this remote area. He had tea with this woman. Look at this woman. She's 75. Look at her face, the wisdom in her face and in her eyes. Look how he captured her. Look at the life lessons she taught him that he wrote about. You'll never get to hear those stories. I met thousands of people around the world. I wrote down so many of their stories and photographed so many of them. I literally took thousands of portraits around the globe. You'll get to see some of them, but you won't get to see most of them. And you won't get to read those stories. I created all of this work despite the pain that I was living in and feeling in my heart, and despite the people around me who were trying to destroy me, who did survive well past me. What was the point? There was no point. That's all I can say to you. There was no point. I don't know what the moral of the story is. I'd love to be able to tie this up for you in a positive note, but I can't. All I can say is, let's go get justice for Aaron. I'm dead now, but let's go get it anyway. And if this goes the way it probably will, or ideally will, they will study my letter, my suicide letter, in psychology classes, in early childhood development classes, and in medical schools or in police departments and the academies, and at DCFS. And they'll say, this happened to Aaron Wulf. Let's make sure it doesn't ever happen to anyone else. Should not have happened to me. I gave people hundreds of chances to make this better, and no one did. And now, you're listening to this only because I'm gone. Thank you for your time. Thank you for listening to this. Please share my letter, my files, this audio, and everything else with everyone that you know. And let's make sure we get justice for Aaron. But again, I wish I had gotten it when I was alive.